Last four meetings of the regular season between teams ranked number one and number two. February 07, Wisconsin losing to number two Ohio State, 49-48. December 10, 2005, number one Duke taking out number two Texas, 97-66. And then we go to February 5th, 1998. Number one Duke losing to North Carolina, 97-73. Anton Jameson, 35-11 for the Heels. February 3rd, 1994, number one Duke losing to number two North Carolina, 89-78. Derek Phelps, Jeff McGinnis, Tar Heels guards combining for 26 points and 12 assists. Did not commit a turnover. Much more on tonight's 1-2 matchup. Back to the College Game Day crew.
Beale Street is popping in Memphis, getting ready for the Tennessee-Memphis showdown in FedEx Forum. This number one versus number two battle just about to lift off. There's Memphis's leading scorer over his last three games, Chris Douglas Roberts, averaging nearly 28 per night. He's a Wooden and Naismith candidate. CDR leading the Tigers, an undefeated season so far, 26-0. And Memphis dreaming of joining immortal teams like Bill Russell's San Francisco squad, undefeated champions at 56. Frank McGuire and the Tar Heels beat Wilt Chamberlain in 57 to finish perfect. Look at all the times the great John Wooden did it. Four times he won the national championship with a perfect record, but the last team to do it, the Indiana Hoosiers in 1976, 32-0, led by Benson and Buckner, but this guy stands in the way. Chris Lofton and Tennessee, the number two team in the country. Latest of the five from the Vols, here's Aaron Andrews.
Well, Reese, for Tennessee, the number two ranking is the highest ever for the men's basketball program, and the players don't want to stop there. Now, usually before a big game, athletes don't even want to talk about anything but the big matchup, but not the Volunteers. During shoot-around today, roommates and teammates Jawan Smith and Tyler Smith told me over the last couple of days, they have actually talked about what it would be like to beat Memphis and be the number one team in the nation. Jawan said to me, why even joke about it? We want to see what it's like to be the top-ranked team. And as Tyler Smith just walked into the Volunteers locker room, he said, we have 40 minutes to find out how sweet it could be. Reese?
And Aaron, 40 minutes, that's a high-priced ticket around here. We just checked eBay, couple of seats, good seats in the FedEx Forum, just went for 10 grand a little while ago on eBay.
It's going to be a great one.
Well, Billis has a deep pocket. Just over an hour away from tip-off, Tennessee and Memphis, guys. Time to take your pick. Who's going to win it, Volunteers or Tigers?
Well, it's going to be a close game, but I've got Tennessee winning this basketball game because of their versatility on the offensive end. It's not just Chris Lofton. It's Jawan Smith. It's Lamar Smith, Tyler Smith, being able to go inside and out, and J.P. Prince coming off the bench. But they're going to have to play terrific defense, really do a good job of boxing out, and limit Memphis to one shot each possession. That'll allow them to get in transition.
I'm going with Memphis. I think they got too much depth. They got the bench. They know how to get up and down the floor. Their pressure defense is just going to wear them down. And from that standpoint, when you look at 40 minutes of basketball, Chris Douglas Roberts, Joey Dorsey inside, and of course, Derrick Rose, his freshman point guard, I think they're just going to go after Tennessee for 40 minutes. They're going to control the boards, and Tennessee's going to miss too many threes. No second chance points. Memphis gets it done.
You know, I like Memphis in this game. I think their ability in transition, also to put the ball on the deck and attack off the dribble, their dribble drive offense, I think will really put a lot of stress on the Tennessee defense. And also, Memphis's great ability to grab offensive rebounds, and those offensive rebounds really lead to easy baskets. I like Memphis in this one, in a tight one.
What tremendous energy there will be in this building tonight. Memphis getting ready. The fabulous freshman Derrick Rose, Robert Dozier, do everything guy for the Tigers, trying to be undefeated, and Bruce Pearl trying to spoil it. College Game Day coming up, top of the hour, guys.
All right, gentlemen, thank you. All right, who will win tonight's matchup?
Well, it's a deadline.
Wow. Look at that, 50-50. Who's carrying Tennessee? Let's see.
Tennessee?
Tennessee carrying Tennessee. Idaho, too close to call.
I always feel like Wolf Blitzer when we do these.
Don't put it above your head. Be a player.
What is the difference between being the best and being perfect?
Well, I'll be honest with you. What you're trying to be is the best. And if perfect follows with that and with your record, that's fine. We're only worried about an undefeated season on April 7th. Hey.
Why do people say we're great defensively? Don't come higher than that. Stop. Don't come higher than that. See, you come higher, you can't get back. Go back. Don't tell me the guy's in your way. Push him out of the way. We strong, we're swarming, we're talking. We look like we have how many guys on defense? Yeah. It's like we got 6, 7, 8 guys on defense.
Every game we play is the biggest game on the other team's schedule, and as a sellout, in most cases, their first sellout of the year, the highest-ranked team to ever play in their building. It has absolutely inspired a school, a team, a state, a city. Now, my question is, being ranked number one and being undefeated, does that inspire us more than it inspires them? If it does, we're fine.
Why'd you take so long to come in? Catch the ball, beat the man, go by him. Great job, Joey. Great job, Joey.
How much pressure is the team under because you haven't lost?
I don't know. You'd have to ask them. I'm trying to take it off of, don't worry about undefeated. Let's just take care of business. And if on April 7th that's it too, we'll have some fun with that too.
John Calipari, Wired Sound. Speaking of, win by Memphis on our closing number gives them 46 consecutive regular season wins, 30 more, and they'll tie UCLA's mark of 76, which they set in the early 70s. And again, you can catch Memphis and Tennessee tonight, 9 Eastern on ESPN.
Closing number, brought to you by Fidelity Investments. Smart move.
45 in a row for Memphis, that's nothing. A couple of milestones Saturday in men's college basketball. Bentley of Massachusetts, Division II record, 53 straight.
Wow.
And on the flip side, the New Jersey Institute of Technology completed the worst season in Division I history at 0-29. But I bet you those kids are nice with a slide rule.
I didn't even know they had a team. Oh, 2 hours.
Apparently they didn't either.
Peace, Stan.
I'm Jay. Game day is next. Enjoy the basketball game. Peace.
Thanks for watching.
What a great setting this is going to be. Beale Street is popping in anticipation of number one against number two in the FedEx Forum tonight. Tennessee against Memphis. Tigers still have dreams of being perfect. Derrick Rose, a sensational freshman. Robert Dozier, a do-everything guy for the undefeated Tigers. But Bruce Pearl hopes his Volunteers can stand in the way. Penny Hardaway here hoping to see his team, Memphis, continue to chase perfection.
Won another national championship. Their seventh in a row.
The Huskers finish a perfect 13-0.
The Dolphins have won Super Bowl VII.
Perfection is doing the best that you can absolutely do with the ability that you have.
The Dolphins have completed the greatest season in NFL history.
Perfection's easy. It's flawless. It's perfect. It's not a number. It's a word.
The search for perfection has to include the exclusion of everything else.
It is history, and bring that trophy back to Lincoln.
Carrying that burden through a whole season can sow the seeds of a little bit extra tension, maybe a team being tight. So it's very difficult to do.
The U of M is a state! The U of M is a state!
A lot of times your opposition is pretty good, and to be perfect, you have to be better.
When you have the best team, the opposition is irrelevant.
It comes down to one word, perfection.
Welcome to College Game Day. Driven by State Farm.
Less than an hour away from tip-off between Memphis and Tennessee. Number one and number two, at least 18,400 fans will pile into FedEx Forum tonight to watch the biggest game of the college basketball season so far. Square off here in a hoops hotbed of Memphis. Tyler Smith, the leader of the Volunteers, a do-everything guy, hoping that his team can move to the top spot in the polls. Aaron Andrews with Tennessee coach Bruce Pearl.
All right, Reese, thank you so much. Coach, we can get the sense and kind of the vibe here in Memphis of how excited everyone is, but what is it like back in Knoxville? What does this game mean to your program?
It means that we're 40 minutes away from being number one in the country if things can work out.
I don't know that we're the best team in the country, but to be able to play a basketball game and for a moment be able to say that you are, it's an exciting opportunity for our basketball team.
You mentioned that this team is used to playing big games because of being in the SEC. We know that the crowd will be behind Memphis. We know the hype that's surrounding it. So what's the most important thing that needs to happen to your club early to keep the crowd out of it?
You have to play well early on the road to win on the road anywhere you go, and probably especially here. So I think our best players need to make a few shots, and you know, if you let Memphis get to the basket, it's going to be a long night. They're so good penetrating that ball. We got to build a wall around that three-point line.
All right, Coach, thank you so much.
Thanks, Aaron.
All right, Reese, back over to you.
All right, Aaron, glad to have you along. College game day from Memphis. Reese Davis along with Hubert Davis, Digger Phelps, and Jay Billis. Tickets are at a premium. We found out that $10,000 paid on eBay for a pair of seats to this one. All of you guys have been involved in games between highly ranked teams, even top two teams in your case, Digger. What's this atmosphere going to be like for the players tonight?
Well, today, this is almost what it's like at the Final Four. When you look at the excitement, especially on Beale Street, and you see how this is coming together, it's no different than what you're going to see April 5th in the Final Four in San Antonio. Matter of fact, Jay, this game might be better than the two games we might see in San Antonio.
It'll be a better atmosphere and certainly more charged. All these players know each other, and you know, Memphis is saying, well, we didn't recruit some of these guys. Tennessee, well, you should have recruited us. And all the guys have bragging rights on the line, but more importantly, they want to be number one. I mean, Tennessee has built a program into being a national power, but it wants to be on the top of college basketball for the first time really ever. This is their highest ranking. To get to number one would be extraordinary for the Volunteers.
You know, you add it back that this is a payback game. You look at Memphis losing by 18 points to Tennessee last year. They looked at this schedule. This is the one game that they circled, and they said they want this game. These are the two best teams in the country now.
And when you have the top two teams in the polls going head-to-head in the regular season, it is a treat. It's not certainly totally unique. We had one last year between Wisconsin and Ohio State back on February 25th. Badgers lost to the Buckeyes 49-48. I think that's going to be the score sometime early in the second half of this one as they go up and down. December of 2005, Duke absolutely destroyed Texas. That was a neutral site game. You know, a road team hasn't won a 1-2 matchup, a true road team, since 91 when Vegas beat Arkansas. Duke and Carolina have gotten together a couple of times as number one versus number two in the 90s. In 98, Duke number one lost on the road. And then February 3rd, 1994, Duke also number one, and they lost by double figures to the Tar Heels in that one as well. So very difficult to go on the road. This is the 38th meeting of one versus two in the regular season. Right now, a one-game edge for number one. See if Tennessee can match that tonight and make it 19 apiece. Memphis, meanwhile, has won 45 in a row in the regular season, the eighth longest winning streak in the regular season in college basketball history. And both coaches have just embraced the bigness of the game. Calipari called it the battle of battles, an ego game. And earlier this afternoon, Bruce Pearl was speaking at a Tennessee pep rally and told a couple of thousand of orange-clad fans, saying, quote, "We are going to tear down that wall around this city, and we are going to kick some tiger backside, posterior, hindquarters, if you get my drift." Both sides understand the magnitude of this game.
Not only recruiting rights, bragging rights for the state, but two very good basketball teams set to do battle.
You know, we're number two right now. They're number one. You know, that's all I need to say. You know, top two teams in the country.
We're the most underrated number one team I've ever seen.
What a feed, what a drive, what a slam.
This is a Memphis team that is as talented as any college basketball team in the country.
They are as talented as any team that we will have had in this building in my 8 years.
Talk about an explosion out of Tennessee. That's what they can do.
It's the biggest game I ever dreamed of, and it's just like a dream come true.
Perfect. Perfection. That's what we want to do.
Ladies and gentlemen, moments ago, the king has entered the building. At least the king of dribble drive motion, if not the king of rock and roll. John Calipari, you see his great record at Memphis. When his team ranked number one in the country, they are 40-4. That goes back to his days at UMass. This is going to rank perhaps atop the great moments in the history of Memphis sports, this number one versus number two matchup. Lennox Lewis knocked out Mike Tyson in Bluff City. Bear Bryant coached his final game of victory over Illinois in the Liberty Bowl in 1982, and Al Geiberger shot a record 59 in the Memphis Classic, and this might just trump them all. Memphis against Tennessee, in-state bragging rights at stake, in addition potentially the number one spot in the polls. Dick Vitale is here. He'll call the game with Dan Shulman tonight. Dick, what are your thoughts about the magnitude of this game?
Well, you know, Reese, George Lapidus is an absolute sports buff here, a journalist, and he says right now, if you read his quotes, that this is the third biggest basketball game in the history of Memphis. Number one, 1956, when the NIT was so big and they played Bradley. 73, when the big redhead, Bill Walton, beats him in the final game of the NCAA championship. And tonight, it is a special night for the state of Tennessee. As Bruce Pearl has said, usually these celebrations and these moments belong to Duke and North Carolina, Kentucky, Indiana. But tonight, this is the basketball toast of America. This is the Mecca. Everybody's excited. Priscilla's in the house. We got Sybil in the house. Peyton Manning and Eli Manning were begging for tickets. They're in the house. I talked to Kenny Chesney a few minutes ago, and he said he couldn't get a ticket. So he's in Boca Raton watching it on TV. I'll tell you one thing. It's going to be special. Significance, I think we all agree. It's much more important, obviously, when they tip off and they play for real in terms of March Madness. But this is about ego. This is about pride. This is about bragging rights. And this is not only about being number one in the nation, but being number one in the state of Tennessee.
And you know, these two schools, they're not close together. They're separated by nearly 400 miles of Interstate 40. But Bruce Pearl has said, we are the University of Tennessee. We want to take our program to every corner of the state. So the turf war is at stake, Jay. Potentially the number one overall seed in the NCAA tournament. What's the biggest thing that can be gained tonight?
Well, I think the confidence to be a champion. I think if you win tonight, you as a team understand that you can win the national championship. You're good enough to do that, especially if you can handle this kind of atmosphere. And I think for Tennessee to handle that on the road would be a big statement for the Volunteers and just how good they are and can be in March.
Yeah, I agree with you that, because this game tonight for Tennessee gives them confidence for March, no matter what happens tonight, win or lose. Chris Lofton's got to come out of the box early and get it done. He's the go-to guy. He's got to get the crowd out of this game. But when you look at Memphis, yeah, they've knocked off Georgetown and Connecticut already. This is another non-conference game. This time of the year, Char, when you look at when you go outside your league, I think it helps your team get better when you look at how that gets done for March.
Yeah, you know, this reminds me of UNC Duke, you know, 1-2 matchup, in-state rivalry, and, you know, playing in those type of games, yeah, you wanted to win. But if you played well in this type of game, this type of atmosphere, you set yourself up to win a national championship. I think the same thing applies in this situation right here. Even the loser in this game can walk away from here and saying, hey, we have a chance to be in San Antonio in April.
And you know what's funny? These two teams have respect for each other. They'll say that, but they really want to look down on the other. So winning gives them the opportunity to look down on them for
both
a while.
Coaches want to look down on each other. You got two of the biggest eagles in college basketball with Bruce and John. Believe me, they both want to be one up on each other.
And it's three with you here.
You know what? That trick.
And Tennessee alums sort of derisively refer to Memphis as Tiger High, and that just gets under the skin of Memphis people. But all of that, the intangibles that goes into this game. Dick, what about the key on the floor tonight?
Well, I think one of the keys, certainly when you look at Memphis, they have to contain the three-point shooting of Lofton. He can't have a big night like he did in the game last year when he went for 34. On the other side, I think Bruce Pearl's going to form a wall around that three-second area, not allow dribble penetration, and make them make medium-range jump shots. Containing Derrick Rose becomes big as well. Remember this, guys. Obama, Clinton, forget about it. Who wins this game gets all the delegates in the state of Tennessee. Could be Calipari, or it could be Mr. Pearl. I can't wait. You guys go to work. I'm going to find Priscilla, and I'm going to get a kiss, my friends, from Priscilla.
Well, if that doesn't work out for you, Dick, you can find Dan Shulman. I'm sure he'll give you a little sugar before the game, too. Dick Vitale will be calling the game along with Dan and Aaron Andrews. We'll talk to you in just a little bit. Ladies and gentlemen, the king's wife at one time has entered the building. Priscilla Presley, among the many dignitaries here to watch this huge game between Memphis and Tennessee tonight. You guys know Graceland was lit up in blue last night as a result. Still to come here on College Game Day, Duke not itself the last couple of games. We'll see how the Dukies tried to bounce back against an overmatched and outmanned St. John's team. And all of a sudden, Kansas getting rocked and chalked on the road. And what does that mean for the Big 12? Maybe a changing of the guard, at least for the moment. And Indiana getting the fresh start without Kelvin Sampson. What's the latest as the Hoosiers go to Northwestern? FedEx Forum will be full. Memphis and Tennessee coming up tonight. The celebrities coming out in mass for this game, including Tennessee alum Peyton Manning, who is part of the most memorable moment in this rivalry in football when his Tennessee Volunteers in 1996 lost against Memphis 21-17. Of course, Manning going on to a storied career, and he's also won a Super Bowl. Indiana, of course, is trying to start over in basketball. The Kelvin Sampson saga ended uneasily on Friday. Sampson resigned and took a $750,000 buyout amidst allegations of NCAA violations over improper phone calls. Now, six guys stepped out and missed the opening practice for Dan Dockage, creating speculation as to whether they would go to Northwestern today. But a little after 10 a.m. Eastern time this morning, everyone present and accounted for on the bus that took them to the plane, as you see Eric Gordon, the star freshman of Indiana, headed toward the bus as Indiana got set to try to get on with its season, a season that has them tied in the loss column for first place in the Big Ten. Wendy Nix has been following this story. Dan Dockage in a very difficult position, Wendy. You spoke to him before the first game against Northwestern tonight.
Reese, I did have the opportunity to talk with Indiana's interim head coach just before tip-off. I asked him in a word to describe this week. He said, well, I guess I would choose interesting. Well, it certainly has been interesting, but what it has not been is routine. And Dockage said, if anything at all, that was the goal of this Indiana coaching staff today, was to make today as routine as possible and about tonight's game. They went through their normal pregame routine. I am told, however, that their pregame meal tonight was, quote, emotional. A lot of players had the opportunity to speak about the chance they had to come together as a team. Then they returned here to the arena about 5:40 local time, where they went through what they would normally do before a game. Dockage was candid. He said, there's no question this team is hurting, but tonight is the first step toward healing. One indication, however, though, that his team has not put Kelvin Sampson in their rearview mirror is that the majority of his players took the court tonight, both in pregames and at tip-off, with the initials KS written on their shoes. That's an indication, a tribute to their former head coach, and perhaps a sign that this program still has some healing to do as they try and move forward with Dan Dockage as their head coach. Reese?
Wendy Nix reporting from Evanston, Illinois, where the Hoosiers are taking on Northwestern tonight. So Indiana does have some healing to do. A great bond formed between Kelvin Sampson and the Indiana players. And there are the initials that Wendy just mentioned as Dockage takes over. He's an Indiana alum. Kevin Coble getting going the other way. And there's the layup. Excuse me, Northwestern scoring there to make it 30-22, as that was Michael Thompson finishing on the layup. Dockage played for 4 years at Indiana. Most notably, is credited with shutting down Michael Jordan in the NCAA tournament when the Hoosiers won that one. Hubert gives me a dirty look. He spent several years on the staff at Indiana assisting Bob Knight. He was the head coach at Bowling Green. He had a record of 16 games over 500 during his career in the Mid-American Conference. Indiana, of course, a team that has great expectations. They can get it together for the postseason. So, too, do the two teams we'll see coming up at the top of the hour. Tennessee and Memphis. Memphis, the only undefeated team remaining in college basketball. Tennessee wanting to stake its claim as king of the state. They have an opportunity coming up in just a few minutes against Memphis. Aaron Andrews spoke with John Calipari not long ago.
All right, Reese, thank you so much. Coach, I know you called tonight an ego game, 1-2, but put that aside, how big is this for the state of Tennessee?
Well, it's big for our state because you have two schools that are part of the same system that anchor both one at one end of the state that's another time zone away that's closer to Washington, D.C. and Atlanta, and then you got little old Memphis down in the other corner, and they're both 1-2 in the country. That's incredible. You have Vandy doing a great job. You have Belmont. You have Middle. You have Tennessee. Tennessee State's doing well. East Tennessee State, Austin Peay. You have a bunch of universities that are really getting it done in basketball right now.
And oh, by the way, little old Memphis, undefeated so far. How has your team dealt with the pressure that comes along with that all year long?
you know, people ask me about the UMass run. That was the first time for us to go and reach to that level. And at the end, it was tough. I'm telling you, I can remember, it was like you had an anvil around your neck. This team won 25 games last year in a row. They won 17 games in a row the year before. The two freshmen that came in won two back-to-back, two state championships, both of them. So these kids are used to winning. I think they're challenged by it, but maybe all these, the pundits, we need a loss. I'm not going to coach to lose, but maybe we do. But we'll see, and I'll know each game that goes on, are they feeling it? Because I'm with them, and normally it'll bump out there if they're a little nervous. Right now, they feel pretty good or seem pretty good anyway.
All right, thank you so much. Thanks. Reese, we'll send it back over to you.
All right, Aaron.
Did he say
is
need a loss?
That's what he said. And Calipari's been saying this week, this is a game they're allowed to lose, and losing is something Tennessee hasn't done much of. They lost to Texas. They lost on the road to Kentucky in a very flat performance. They're certainly very capable of beating Memphis. Tennessee, Bruce Pearlman says, more important to him to win the SEC outright. It's been 41 years since the Volunteers have been able to do that. Six different players have led Tennessee in scoring this year. A very balanced and varied attack. Chris Lofton is the leading scorer, but he by no means is the only offensive threat. All right, Calipari says they're allowed to lose this game.
Why did he say that?
That's different.
He said pundits. That leaves Digger out.
Oh, okay. Right. So if somebody is going to beat Memphis, and if that somebody is Tennessee, how do they do it?
Well, I think Tennessee needs somebody to go off, somebody to have a big game, and I think that guy is Chris Lofton. Remember, in the game last year, he had 34 points, and over the last nine games this season, he's been absolutely fantastic, shooting over 50% from three-point range, averaging 19 points a game. His ability to come off a screen, shoot with range, takes this team to a different level. I think defensively, they got to do a good job of dribble penetration, really keeping Memphis out of the middle, make them shoot from the outside. They've been struggling from three-point range, and then when they shoot from the outside, box out and get the rebound. Memphis is an outstanding offensive rebounding team. You want to limit them to one shot every possession. If you can do that, you can win.
I think one of the keys to beating Memphis, you've really got to limit turnovers against Memphis. You know, Tennessee has to have their offense help their defense. And anytime you play against a team that's as good defensively as Memphis, if you cough the ball up and let them get runouts and easy baskets, you are in for an awfully long night. That is throwing gasoline on a fire. You can see now Tennessee bringing the ball up. They're loose with it. Alabama takes it away. If this is Memphis, they will get up like Scenario Hillman and drop that thing down on you. Then you've got to control this Memphis team in transition. That means stopping the ball, stopping Derrick Rose, and make Memphis play a half-court game. Make them take jump shots. Don't let them get to the rim. And the last thing, the offensive boards are a big point of scoring for Memphis. You've got to keep Memphis off the offensive glass. That means all five guys for Tennessee have got to block out, and they've got to go to the defensive glass. Your defensive possession is not over until you get the ball, and Tennessee has got to gang rebound in this game, or they don't have a chance.
This crowd is already starting to rock here in Memphis, and as I look around the 18,400 seats, they've spread out the orange. You're not going to have a big pocket of orange anywhere in this building. It should give Memphis a big noise advantage, so what about trying to take the crowd out of the game?
I really think Bruce Pearl can take the crowd out of the game. Chris Lofton's the leader on this team. He's got to play big the first 4 minutes, take control in the game, his shots, getting the ball to Tyler Smith, Juwan Swift, but also, I heard Calipari today in the shoot-arounds say, guys, there's rumors, I heard rumors that maybe we're going to see some zones tonight. Shoot from your zone spot. I can see Tennessee going full-court contained press, back in the zone just to mix defenses, but Lofton's got to lead the charge on the offense. The first 4 minutes, they jump out like 10-2, they take the crowd out of the game, now you control the game for the next 36 minutes.
Everybody's expecting high scoring. Are you expecting it to be as high scoring as many have said?
I think once again, I don't care who jumps out early, they're just going to go up and down when they get it going because they both are great transition teams. But the key is going to be turnovers. Who gets points off turnovers is going to be the big factor. And when you look at what goes on, Memphis really eats that up. But Memphis will do a better job getting second chance points because when you look at Tennessee, they're not a good offensive rebounding team.
Tennessee has improved its rebounding of late, but certainly not at the caliber caliber of Memphis over the course of the season. Tennessee and Memphis coming up at the top of the hour. One of two teams to beat the Volunteers this year, the Kentucky Wildcats. The Wildcats trying to make a late season push toward the bubble. We'll get you up to date.
A perfect 13-0.
The Dolphins have won Super Bowl 7.
Perfection is doing the best that you can absolutely do with the ability that you have.
The Dolphins have completed the greatest season in NFL history.
Perfection's easy. It's flawless. It's perfect. It's not a number. It's a word.
The search for perfection has to include the exclusion of everything else.
It is history. And bring that trophy back to Lincoln.
Carrying that burden through a whole season can sow the seeds of a little bit extra tension, maybe a team being tight. So it's very difficult to do.
The U of M is a state! The U of M is a state!
Not a lot of times your opposition is pretty good. And to be perfect, you have to be better.
When you have the best team, the opposition is irrelevant.
It comes down to one word, perfection.
Memphis is the only team that can attain perfection this season and join these immortal clubs like the 1956 USF team, Bill Russell 29-0 in 57. Brent McGuire and the Tar Heels beat Wilt Chamberlain in Kansas and won it all. John Wooden did it four times, the legendary UCLA coach most recently in 73, and the last team to run the table, go undefeated, Indiana in 1976, Buckner, Benson, and May going 32-0 on their way to the title. Memphis is just the sixth team since 1990 to start a season at least 26-0. Tigers try for number 27 tonight. Illinois in 04-05, 29-0 for losing to Ohio State. Then they lost to Carolina in the national championship game. Bill Martelli in St. Joe's started 27-0 in 2004. They lost in the A-10 tournament first round, made it to the Elite Eight, and fell to Oklahoma State. Stanford in 04, 26-0, eventually didn't even make it out of the first weekend of the NCAA tournament, losing to Alabama. Massachusetts, coached by John Calipari, went 26-0 and then lost a home game in February. Sound familiar? To George Washington, will history repeat tonight? And UNLV started 34-0 in 1991 before they lost to Duke in the Final Four, spoiling their bid for a perfect season. Let's go on the floor right now. The fabulous point guard for the Tigers, Derrick Rose.
I think Derrick Rose may be the ultimate key to this game. He's got size, he's got speed, he's got strength. If he's aggressive and penetrating and attacking off the dribble, there are not many players in the country, if anyone, that can stay in front of Derrick Rose. He's truly outstanding.
Well, you look at Ramar Smith of Tennessee. He's playing extremely well right now. Came off his season high 19 points against Auburn earlier this week. He will be guarding Derrick Rose. Got to do a good job of keeping him out of the middle and also taking care of the basketball. Guard play is going to be huge for Tennessee tonight.
Chris Douglas Roberts, he's the go-to guy. When they struggled at UAB, he had 32 points, but he had the three-point play to win it at the end. This is one guy tonight that will dominate this game. If the rest of Memphis is struggling, he can take it over because he's that great a scorer, knows how to get it done.
Chris Lofton will be the best shooter on the floor tonight. He put 34 on Memphis last year. He is 28 points away from 2,000 for his career. He's hit 40 of his last 81 three-point attempts over his last nine games. He has been scalding the SEC's all-time leader in threes.
And another versatile guard for Tennessee, Juwan Smith. And this is the guy that really pulled him at the beginning of the season. This is a guy that can really go off offensively. He's really struggled on the road. He was 0 of 7, had 0 points in this game last year. He's got to step it up tonight.
And you are going to be able to hear exactly what the Tennessee Volunteers here in the locker room from their head coach, Bruce Pearl.
And the key to our victory last year against Memphis was they shot 29%. We built the wall. We made them shoot contested jump shots. We kept them off the offensive boards and the foul line, okay? So make rebounding and building that wall and some ball pressure your number one priority.
of four. There are Tennessee fans here. It seems that their tickets have been spread out around the arena. There in the midst, there's little pockets of orange mixed in with the sea of blue in FedEx Forum as we get ready for Tennessee and Memphis coming up tonight. The Volunteers trying to knock off the number one team in the land. Tennessee has never played in a one versus two game. Bruce Pearl, a master motivator who has built a program in Knoxville and awakened a sleeping giant in college basketball. He had this to say to his team as they got ready to take the floor to take on Memphis tonight.
Passion, poise, and purpose. Passion, poise, and purpose allow us to win on the road. We're going to play with passion, and we're going to have poise when they make their run, poise when they block shots, poise when they talk to us, poise when it gets elevated a little bit. Because everything we do with a purpose. The way we guard, the way we rebound, the way we fast break, and the way we execute, okay? I don't know if we're the best team in the country. I don't know if we are. But I do know we're 40 minutes away from being the number one team in the country. Bam!
Let's get it. Let's take care of business. Together on three. One, two, three. Together. Go.
You won't find two more charismatic guys on the sideline than John Calipari and Bruce Pearl, who has his Volunteers ready to go into this hostile environment. What about the Pontiac game changer for the one versus two battle tonight, Digger?
I'm going with the silent enforcer, Antonio Anderson of Memphis. The 6'6 guard forward knows how to score, gets a lot of things done. He had 27 points in a win against UAB, and he leads the team in minutes of game played. He's the guy, watch out for tonight. He'll get the points they need under pressure.
My game changer is Chris Douglas Roberts, the leading scorer for Memphis, averaging over 18 points per game. He shoots 56% from the field, just under 50% from three over his last three games, over 27 points per game. They got to stop him to win.
My guy is Chris Lofton from Tennessee. He had 34 points in this game last year. He was a difference maker. Tonight he has to step up. This is a guy that's been playing well in the last nine games, shooting over 50% from three-point range, 19 points a game. He takes this team to a different level when he can knock down that three-point shot.
My game changer is the NCAA's active leader in rebounds, Joey Dorsey. Dorsey has 1,100 rebounds in his career. He's averaging over 10 per game. 51 times in his career, he's had double-figure rebounds, and in those games, Memphis is 48-3. If he can get those stickbacks and putbacks and clean up the misses, that could bode very well for the Tigers in this game tonight.
That's a kiss of death.
Here we go again.
You think I'm taking care of him now?
Wow.
Memphis is number one in the land, 26-0. That's their record right now, trying to go to 27 and trying to win 30 for the third straight year. But next, they've got the in-state battle against the Volunteers. Both teams trying to stake their territory in the Volunteer State. Memphis has the richer tradition. Tennessee trying to step up. Time now for the Pontiac prime time pick. Who do you have?
I'm not going to change my pick. I know. Man, it's going to be a close game. When I look at Tennessee, their versatility on the offensive end, but they've got to rebound the basketball. If they can do that, they can pull away a road
win. I'm going with Memphis. I like their depth. I like the crowd. I like the action going up. John Calipari gets it done.
I'm going with Memphis because their ability to guard and their ability to offensive rebound. I think Memphis wins in a great ball game.
The ticket prices have gone through the roof, and now the energy in this building is starting to raise the roof as well. Tennessee getting hyped. This is a special and unique game tonight. Number one against number two. The Tigers and the Volunteers. We'll see you at halftime. Dan Shulman is ready for the call for this big-time showdown.
Reese, the fans here in Tennessee are ready for arguably the biggest college basketball game ever played in this state. It's number one Memphis, unbeaten on the season, and winners of 47 in a row at home, taking on their in-state rivals, Tennessee, number two in the country, the highest ranking ever achieved by this program. And has Elvis left the building, or is he here? Ah, it's Dickie V. Number one and number two are next.
Settle in, folks.
ESPN, promise, positive vibes.
Well, you know it's a big game win. Priscilla Presley.
Presley is in the house here in Memphis tonight. Peyton Manning somehow got a ticket and was brave enough to wear orange. And former Memphis State star Penny Hardaway is here in the building as well. They are all here to see number one against number two from the FedEx Forum here in Memphis. Welcome to ESPN Saturday Night Primetime, presented by DirecTV. And how much fun is this going to be? This doesn't happen all that often, especially with two teams right in the same state. You looking forward to this one?
I'll tell you, it should be really exciting. You got both clubs that transition basketball up and down the floor. Two coaches that got an unbelievable personality and lots of enthusiasm. Star players, Lofton, Douglas Roberts, undefeated, the only unblemished team in America, Memphis, and Tennessee, number two, trying to be number one for the first time in the history of Tennessee men's basketball.
We are lucky we got these seats. Otherwise, we had no shot at getting into this building tonight. How about the Chevron Star Watch tonight?
Well, you know, you talk about Star Watch, you got to go with the two. Chris, I tell you, Lofton certainly is going to have to be big here today, making threes. He's going to really have to be effective. On the other side, Chris Douglas Roberts has been on fire. The last three games, 27.7. Explosive, athletic. He's got to get to the rack.
Well, as if this place could get any noisier, as if there could be any more excitement here in the building. Time now for the Tigers starting lineup.
Starting at guard, a 6'6" junior from Lynn, Massachusetts. Number five, Antonio Anderson. Starting at guard, a 6'7" junior from Detroit, Michigan. Number 14, Chris Douglas Roberts. Starting at guard, a 6'3" freshman from Chicago, Illinois. 23, Derek Rose! Starting at forward, a 6'9" junior from Livonia, Georgia. Number two, Robert Dozier! And at forward, a 6'9" senior from Baltimore, Maryland. Number three,
So there you have it, the starting lineup for the Memphis Tigers as they practically ripped the roof off here at the FedEx Forum. Now, how about the Tennessee Volunteers? Here's the starting lineup for them. This is a deep and talented bunch with three Smiths in the starting lineup. None of them are related. Ramar Jawan in the backcourt along with Chris Lofton, one of the great shooters in college basketball. Tyler Smith and Wayne Chisholm providing the size up front. A win tonight, and the Vols are the number one team in the nation. Evan Andrews tells us how they feel about that.
Well, Dan, first of all, if you don't think this game means a lot to both these teams, you are crazy. Two incidents already. These two teams had to be separated when they were in the same area, in the hallway and when they came out on the court. And when you talk about big games, normally athletes don't want to talk about anything else about the, except for the task at hand. But when I talked to Tennessee players and roommates, Jawan and Tyler Smith, they said for the past couple days they have been talking in their apartment about what could happen if they beat Tennessee. They said, why even lie about it? If we beat Memphis, we will be the number one team in the nation. They said it's something they have brought up all week. Coach Pearl even brought it up in his pregame discussion, Dan.
Well, they are fired up. The players, the fans, the guys sitting beside me getting ready to broadcast the game. 38th meeting all time between number one and number two. Just the fifth time ever a number one and number two from the same state have met. And at the end of the day, both of these teams still have a chance to win a national championship. But Aaron Support said it all. This game means a ton to these players and everybody who lives in this state.
Well, you know, it's about ego. It's about bragging rights. That's what's really at stake tonight. However, when you put it in perspective, I really believe next Tuesday night, my friend, is a bigger game for Tennessee at Vanderbilt. Why? Because they want to win the SEC championship outright. They haven't done it in 41 years. But it is special because Memphis wants to go unblemished. We've all talked about if they win this game, they will be 34-0 in my mind come tournament time. The first unbeaten team since 91 to enter.
to the tournament since Jerry Tarkanen and UNLV.
We are underway here in Memphis. Deafening noise here at the FedEx Forum. And a quick foul is drawn as Juwan or Tyler Smith drives to the basket. Here's Bruce Pearl, just his third year as the head coach in Knoxville. And Dick, what an incredible job he has done, not only the wins and losses, but rejuvenating the program, revitalizing the fan base there.
Well, he's really brought that personality, that spirit. He's also accepted the fact that the success of Pat Summitt. You know, Tennessee's had a lot of success in basketball with Pat Summitt, as you look at John Calipari and the amazing job that he has done since arriving in Memphis.
40-4 all time when coaching the number one ranked team. Remember, he was UMass's coach back in the Marcus Camby era, and they had a long run as the number one team in the nation.
Well, he beat three number ones while at Mass. He beat Arkansas at number one. He beat North Carolina, and he also beat Kentucky.
Not a lot of love lost between the two coaches. We'll touch on that later on. A blocked shot. Memphis had it, lost it. And the three goes down from the corner for Juwan Smith. And John Calipari's going to use a timeout 35 seconds into this game. Well, Tennessee winning the hustle battle in the first 30 seconds, an offensive rebound, getting a loose ball, then knocking down a three. And I mean, those Memphis players, Dick, were in the huddle for about 3 seconds before John Calipari sent him back out on the floor.
Went on a two on a free throw line for Tennessee. Not a good free throw shooting team. The last 4 minutes of the game, that can become big because Memphis is the worst in Division I, shooting free throws, 58% as a team.
Derrick Rose for three, and Memphis is on the board.
That's big. If he starts making shots, I think one of the keys of the game, he must contain the penetration of Rose.
Both teams score better than 80 points per game. Both of them want to get up and down the floor. This could be a track meet here tonight.
Both like the pressure defensively as well. Strong defensive team when you look at Memphis. Very similar to what Jerry Tarkanian had in 91.
So many of these players know each other. So many of them were recruited by one school, not necessarily the other. Backdoor feed. Four on the shot clock. Juwan Smith again.
Oh, the rated threes, baby, early in this game.
When we asked John Calipari this morning, what are you most worried about? He said Juwan Smith. You think maybe Lofton or the pressure. He talked about Juwan Smith's ability to make shots.
This man-to-man defense really looks almost like a zone.
Derrick Rose with the answer.
He said, hey, who said I can't shoot? He went 2-for-13 against UAB.
Lamar Smith with the handoff and the strong finish inside by Tyler Smith, the transfer out of Iowa.
You got so many good athletes on the floor, players that can go up and down the floor. They're sitting in that zone. They're going to make them try to beat them from the perimeter.
Antonio Anderson will bury a three.
We talked about as one of my keys. I said Memphis had to make the three tonight because they're going to cut off the driving lane.
Three threes for the Tigers.
And they're answering that by making that perimeter shot. And that is not a strong suit of Memphis.
Here's Lofton, number five, better than 400 made threes in his career. Fifth all time in NCAA Division I history.
He's probably going to finish number two to J.J. Redick.
Yep. Chisholm looking for help. The shot clock into single digits again.
See, Chisholm can bring the big guy away from the basket. He can shoot the three.
Lamar Smith with the penetration and the teardrop, and the Vols take the lead again.
You know, Lamar Smith played on an AAU team in Detroit with Chris Douglas Roberts. We are family. Name of the team was Family, not Chuck Tanner and the Pirates.
Anderson draws the foul.
Take a look at Derrick Rose. Great penetrator, showing he can also shoot the long-range jump shot. And then you're going to watch Mr. Smith on the other side, Juwan.
Juwan Smith, a senior out of Cleveland, Tennessee. Bruce Pearl has three senior guards who get regular minutes. Dozier. In and out, a rebound, Dorsey. That's a huge factor tonight.
Well, that's what he does really well. His strength is rebounding, keeping the ball alive on a glass.
Here's their leading scorer, Chris Douglas Roberts, off to Rose, who has the hot hand early. Rebound off the miss by Tyler Smith. What an all-round talent he is, but he turns it over in transition.
Out of control, he's got to go to the middle with it right now.
Rose to Dozier, who is fouled.
Juwan Smith had a 32-point game against Arkansas, and then his last two games went 5-for-16.
The foul on Juwan Smith, his first.
You know, both these clubs really pride themselves playing defense, recruiting athletes that you can utilize in multi-dimensional ways.
Ramar Smith out, in a fifth-year senior. Jordan Howell comes in. Here's what's at stake for Memphis, unbeaten on the year. 45 in a row in the regular season, 47 wins in a row here at home. This is a program that has advanced to the Elite Eight each of the last 2 years. Tennessee got as far as the Sweet 16 a year ago. Both of these teams lost to the eventual national runner-up, Ohio State.
Yeah, Fat Bottom knows a little bit about both clubs. And they have Conley and Odom. Conley now in town here. I think this Memphis team is probably the best basketball team in the city.
You think they beat the Grizzlies?
Probably. I mean, the Grizzlies winning any games at all? I mean, I can't believe they gave up Gasol. They gave the Lakers a chance to go for the world title.
Foul on J.P. Prince and Robert Dozier to the line for the Tigers. It is bedlam. Just an unbelievable atmosphere here in this building. Tickets selling for hundreds, if not thousands of dollars. You talked about it. Memphis about as bad as it gets shooting free throws.
You know, I talked to John about that before the game. He was posted, as you look here, at some of the free throw percentages of clubs that have won national titles. I said, you've got to be concerned about their free throw shooting ability. He said, I am not concerned. He said, late in the game, we will make them when it counts. He said, it is not a dilemma. Wow. I don't know if I buy that.
A turnover. Anderson for three.
Got to get a better shot. Three on one. You got to get a better shot than that.
Dorsey gets back his miss and is fouled before the shot. Man, you got to want the basketball here tonight, or somebody's going to rip it right from you.
There is so much ego on the floor, so much pride at stake. They're playing not for being number one only in the United States of America. They want to be number one in Tennessee.
Yep.
And as I told the guys earlier tonight, I said, Obama and Clinton, forget about this state. Whoever wins here tonight, yep, Pearl or Mr. Calipari, will get all the delegate votes.
Offensive foul, Robert Dozier. Bruce Pearl likes that. John Calipari warned his team today about Tennessee players trying to step in and take charges. That was a big focus in their shoot-around this morning.
A little chip on a shoulder, too. John Calipari plays with that. He constantly, we against the world mentality, always building up. I could have given his pregame speech. This is the game. All the media thinks we're getting beat. I can hear him talking right now to the team.
I keep hearing his players saying how they're the most underappreciated
number one.
I don't know who underappreciates them.
Exactly.
They got a great team. We got two great teams here tonight. That's the first missed shot by Tennessee, but another offensive rebound. And of the two teams, Memphis is a much better rebounding team.
That's because of the presence of Dorsey.
Nice pass. Cruz inside, and Chisholm misses the layup.
Got to convert those, and you get that two-man play on the interior. See, I think you're going to establish a little inside play here.
Nothing but three so far for Memphis, but they're dropping more often than not. Gustavus Roberts.
He's a pro, there's no doubt about it. He's the premier wing player in the USA.
Got a chance to be a first-team All-American by the end of the season. He's having an outstanding year.
They showed a real unbelievable resilience when they were down 7 with a minute 22 to go against UAB and won the game last Saturday.
Another Tennessee turnover. That was the closest call that Memphis has had all season. Anderson, another three!
Who said they're only an average shooting team? Well, are they shooting the trifecta tonight?
Bruce Pearl's going to let the balls play through it.
He told me on the phone call yesterday, he said, if they beat us shooting the three, they deserve to win.
Tip your cap. They better have hand signals for their plays, because nobody's hearing anything here tonight.
Tough play, bad play. Can't make that pass. Impossible.
Rose the pull-up three.
Eventually, they're going to get cold. They are not a great shooting team. I really buy the philosophy of Bruce Pearl, letting him try to beat him from the perimeter.
Juwan Smith is beating him from the perimeter. His third three already in this game.
I tell you, those Smiths, Juwan, Ramar, Tyler, what a story. Tyler coming back to Tennessee, played in Iowa. It's been documented. His dad passing away. The NCAA showed a lot of heart,
yeah,
and a lot of compassion in allowing him to be eligible this year.
Here's a steal by Pearl.
Got it back, turned it over. Tennessee sloppy with the ball early.
This is where Rose really excels.
Sean Taggart wide open. They are white hot right here tonight from beyond the arc.
I tell you, John Calipari cannot believe it. I don't care what he says. There is no way that he can believe that they are making threes like that tonight.
They've made six already. Tennessee's made three. Last year, the Vols won by 18 in Knoxville. Chris Lofton had 34 points in that game.
You know, he was in a shooting slump earlier this year, but then after the Kentucky loss, he really got on fire.
He's on the bench now, but there hasn't been a whistle in a long time. Look at that shot. Not a good shot by Smith. And count the bucket. Basket and a foul for Duke Cruz takes us to a much-needed breather here at the FedEx Forum. Man, are these two teams, Dick, lighting it up from outside in the early going.
I tell you, they're on fire. Nothing but nylon. Shoot the trifecta, baby. Hey, is Elvis in the house?
Perfect is
a circle,
a sunset,
a snowflake, an idea.
Perfect is a season.
Well, so far, Memphis is perfect. Unbeaten on the year at 26-0. Can they run the table? Can they do what these teams did? Bill Russell in 1956 leading the Dons to a 29-0 season. Frank McGuire coaching the Tar Heels to a perfect season a year later. Of course, UCLA, success that will never be reached again. The big redhead there in on a couple of those teams. And the last team to go undefeated through an entire season to Bob Knight's Indiana Hoosiers.
Well, you know, Bob Knight probably went back-to-back undefeated in terms of the year prior, lost one game because they were without Scott May. Hey, right now Memphis, the last two plus seasons, they are 92-8. John Calipari just won his 400th game. I'm telling you, staying here, he's gonna win a lot of games.
Duke Cruz knocks down the free throw. Tennessee back within three. You saw 10 of the 11 shots attempted by the Tigers have been threes. Andre Allen is into the game now at the point, a tenacious defender for Memphis. Chris Lofton is among those who have returned for Tennessee. Dorsey inside, and fouling him is Ramar Smith as we check in with Aaron Andrews.
Dan, I have no idea how both of these coaches still have their coats on. I was just listening to Bruce Pearl's huddle, and he was, needless to say, intense. He reminded his team, look, they are making threes that they normally do not make. Do not leave them open, and sooner or later, they will stop falling. Dan?
All right, Aaron, by the way, if you're wondering why Bruce Pearl's not wearing the orange blazer that you've sometimes seen as you adjust your television set at home, the famous coach, late coach Ray Mears, talked to Bruce Pearl about it, and Bruce said, can I wear the orange jacket in honor of you? This was a couple of years ago, and Coach Mears said yes. And Bruce Pearl said, who should I wear it against? And he said, well, I always wore it against Vanderbilt and Kentucky. So those are the two schools where the orange jacket comes out. But Bruce Pearl did say this morning, you know what? If we ever get to a Final Four, it might have to make an appearance again.
You know, Ray Mears did a great job. He and his assistant, Stu Aberdeen, both did a phenomenal job while at Tennessee. Had the Bernie Ernie show at one time.
Hard to believe that the program's never gone deeper than the Sweet 16, but this group certainly has the potential.
Haven't won an SEC title in 41 years.
Yeah, outright. Andre Allen with a block from behind. It'll be Antonio Anderson and Andre Allen, the two primary defenders on Chris Lofton tonight.
You know, it's really amazing. If you're Bruce Pearl and you want to feel a little bit good right now, Lofton has not scored. You're down four, and they're on fire shooting threes. I mean, think about that. You're right in the game. Yep. Your star hasn't scored, and you're down four, and they're on fire.
Tennessee has played very well on the road this year. It won't drop for Tyler Smith. The follow misses as well. And Dorsey comes down with a rebound.
Well, in the two losses, Texas beat him. Nice transition. Got to make that layup. Got the cool angle right there going to the goal.
Jeff Robinson misses the layup. Ramar Smith, good patience. And he misses one from in close. Brian Williams hits the floor, and there's a hold going against the Tigers. The Vols are getting the loose balls, getting the rebounds right now in a game loaded with intensity. They got into it a little bit in the tunnel before the game. They continue to go chest to chest here on the court.
coming. Get out of way.
Down to the top 25 every night of college basketball. We'll announce the number one player of all time during the Carolina Duke game on March the 8th. There's the impressive resume for Jerry Lucas, number 11 on the all-time list.
Well, you know, Bob Knight has told me on numerous occasions that Jerry Lucas's former teammate was as fundamentally solid as anybody he has ever seen for a big player.
So there's number 11 through 15.
Wow.
I mean, you take these five. Wow. How do you lose?
I mean, not bad, huh?
Yet there's 10 guys that are going to be ranked higher than them.
Well, you know, you're talking about guys that left early. That's why Magic Johnson, Michael Jordan.
Right. The lob for Brian Williams. He can't come up with it. And here comes Andre Allen. Robinson knocks it in. Nice touch.
Well, he did a great job reversing the ball. Allen with the good extra pass. Played under control. This Memphis team, what's always really impressed me about John Calipari's club is that they've been able to meet every challenge. Everybody plays at another level against them. Even teams that are inferior play at such a high level, you got to forget about their records.
They obviously don't get the challenges in their conference that some of the other big-time teams get in theirs, but they've beaten the likes of Georgetown, Gonzaga, UConn, Arizona, and others on their way to a 26-0 record. Another
That's three, and shot.
There's a miss by Willie Kemp.
He shot that from Graceland. That's a bad, bad shot. I'll tell you this, you know, beating the teams they beat, you mentioned Georgetown, Connecticut, Arizona, Southern Cal, Gonzaga, Oklahoma. I mean, that's an impressive list.
Yes. Sean Taggart, wearing a mask after suffering a broken nose a week ago, comes up with a block with the left hand.
Yeah, the left hand because it's a right-handed shooter, left hand. Most of the great shot blockers, David Robinson, the best of them all, Bill Russell, lefty.
Tyler Smith, their leading assist guy, despite the fact he's a forward. Plenty of time. Ramar Smith, and they miss another layup. Chisholm with a follow.
Chisholm with the good aggressive offensive rebound. We talked about also on the top of the show, key contain Lofton, and they have done a brilliant job containing him here tonight.
These two schools, Dick, separated by almost 400 miles. Memphis in the west end of the state, and Tennessee in the east end of the state in Knoxville. Vanderbilt in the middle in Nashville. There's a lot of great basketball being played in this state. You look at Austin Peay and others. This is one of the hotbeds right now.
Exactly. Yeah. Kevin Stallings is so underrated at Vanderbilt, the job he has done.
And you talked about a Tennessee at Vandy Tuesday night, 9 Eastern, right here on ESPN.
I think Forster's got to be MVP in the league. You hear Jamon Gordon, because these teams maybe have great players when you talk team like Tennessee, but they spread it out so much their offensive firepower.
Boy, Tyler Smith is tough. You talked about the story. He transferred back from Iowa to Tennessee. His father died of lung cancer. He's got a tattoo of a couple of teardrops coming down from his left eye, and a nice move by the NCAA, a compassionate move.
Absolutely.
To waive the year off, and he was eligible to play immediately.
Look at him shooting that three.
CDR again.
He gives you CPR, baby. I'll tell you that. That kid is, without a doubt, one of the five best players in the United States.
Well, right now, Memphis has 7 3-point field goals and only 1 2-pointer. Battle for the ball. Taggart comes up with it.
Tennessee cannot win this game unless Lofton starts making some threes.
Yep. CDR again. What a pace. It's a good thing both of these teams are deep. They're going to need all their bodies tonight.
Well, they're going to the bench. See right there. Poor job defensively. John Calipari's got to be really upset with the defensive effort in transition. Can't be happy with that play. Watch this right now. The defense allows a big gap. He goes right in. You can put a Mack truck through there.
Ramar Smith, the bucket, the foul on Antonio Anderson, his second, and he is a good scorer for them, but really a great defender. That is his best role, and he'll sit down now with a couple of fouls, as among those who check back in, Derrick Rose and also Donnell Mack, a sophomore out of Charlotte.
Well, you know, Mack's going to shoot threes. That's his expertise. Ramar Smith from out of the Motor City. How do they let him get out of the state? Matty Thomas will let him get out of the state when people at Michigan.
Ramar Smith having a big start. He and Jawan Smith are really carrying the balls offensively right now. And here's something that Memphis worked on extensively today as well, this pressure, getting the ball inbounds and trying to get down the floor.
Well, they're going to four-court trap. You know that. There it is right there. See, post to the opposite side. Bring the ball away from the trap.
Roberts on a tear, averaging better than 27 points per game in his last three after a couple of down games because of the flu. And there's Lofton reaching in and committing the foul.
Judgment Week presented by Jockey is on ESPN at 7 Eastern. Number 24 Marquette, which routed Rutgers today, taking on a Villanova team that pulled off an upset over UConn today. And then Texas and Kansas State in the late game. Texas beat Oklahoma today. Kansas State is underway against Baylor.
Hey, you talk about National Coach of the Year. What about some consideration for Rick Barnes and the job he's doing at Texas? Think about it.
Robinson for three. This is unbelievable.
And raining threes here in Memphis tonight. That was the coaching plan defensively by Tennessee. Let him shoot the three.
Offensive foul, J.P. Prince. That's his second. And the last foul, Dick, was on Lofton. His second, and he's gone back to the bench.
Prince, a very valuable guy, coming off the bench, transferred away of Arizona. Highly rated out of the scholastic ranks.
Now he's got to sit down as Bruce Pearl goes deeper. Josh Tabb will come into the game, and we've got a 30-second timeout.
You know, you would think the way they're shooting the three, that you'd look at the scoreboard and they'd be down about 15 when you talk. I mean, think about the way they're shooting the threes. Derrick Rose, they got everybody involved. In fact, they had seven guys that have scored already tonight.
8 for 15 as a team, Dick, from beyond the arc. A team that shoots 34% as a team on the year from three.
See, I really think good philosophy, good strategy. What they're trying to do, Memphis Sports Illustrated had a great, great picture and broke down the offensive system of Memphis. They want to beat you off the drive, beat you with the dribble, get to the basket, get good spacing. They're taking that away by going zone and letting them shoot the three, but they never anticipated that they would be this effective.
Memphis with 8 assists on their 9 baskets. 8 of their 9 baskets are threes. Chris Lofton scoreless and on the bench with 2 fouls, yet Tennessee is within 5.
You know, for the season, I just looked it up statistically, Tennessee has made 90 more threes than their opponents, basically because of Lofton. But tonight, Memphis has the edge 8-3.
With Lofton out, Josh Tabb into the game. He is a superior defender, and he draws Derrick Rose, who goes right by him, but misses the floater.
Derrick Rose out of the Windy City, one of the type of dandies in America, certainly one of the real impact freshmen.
Ramar Smith sneaks inside. He has been penetrating almost at will tonight. Tough bounce pass into traffic, stolen by Rose. Donnell Mack.
That's his expertise. He's the guy that can only shoot the three.
Robinson goes flying, and here come the balls. Jawan Smith spins, and Dorsey came over and got a finger on it.
Dorsey, great job rotating over, closing off the driving angle.
In the game last year up in Knoxville, Dick, Dorsey fouled out in
early
only 15 minutes, had 13 rebounds. If they can keep him on the floor, he's a game changer.
Yeah, 2 points in a game, 13 rebounds, but he got in foul trouble early, and Tennessee just blew him out. They also shot 29% Memphis in that game.
This is the third year of an 8-year series. They alternate back and forth between Knoxville and here. No neutral site games elsewhere in the state. Douglas Roberts, in and out.
That's what he does well, taking it to the goal. I know for a fact, though, that Memphis doesn't want to go to Knoxville.
Yeah.
In the next series, they want to play on a neutral. They want to play in Nashville.
Well, they got a few years to deal with the home and home. And really, when you look at the environment here, and we weren't there, but you can imagine what the environment was like last year and will be next year. How can you deny? I mean, this is a series that has to be played somewhere.
Oh, absolutely. They're going to play. There's no question they're going to play. It's just a matter of fact they're trying to play in Nashville.
Yeah. Double team on Tyler Smith. 3 on the shot clock. Jawan Smith. And it is out of bounds to the Tigers.
You know, Memphis does a great job defensively, taking you out of any kind of system you want to run. I love the enthusiasm of both these leaders. These two guys become so contagious to their players.
The story tonight, Dick, the threes for Memphis. They have made 8 of them already, and that's why they've got the lead. All right, Scott, well, number 1 and number 2 here. The 38th all-time meeting between the top 2 teams in the rankings. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. And when you got a game this big, you're going to have the queen in the house, or at least the wife of the king, Priscilla Presley, who last night lit up Graceland, Memphis Blue.
3, 2, 1, light them up.
So Well, she lit up Graceland last night, and she made Dickie V a happy guy tonight. I know your wife is here, but she gave you a kiss on the cheek, didn't she?
I got a big kiss. I used to have a crush on her, I told her, when I was younger. Hey, Peyton's in the house. His brother Eli spoiled a team that was going for an unblemished year.
That's right.
The Patriots. But at least Tom Brady, consolation, he went home to Giselle Bundchen. What a consolation that is.
I'd like to make a correction. You used to have a crush on Priscilla Presley?
Wow. I got a crush on Lorraine McGrath now.
5-point lead for Memphis. They've made 8 threes and 1 2-point field goal in this game. Chris Lofton, the leading scorer for the Vols, scoreless and on the bench with 2 fouls.
That is so big. They got to get Lofton involved in the second half.
Baseline jumper not there for Howell.
There's that medium range jump shot falling away, Howell.
Down to 38% from the field. Their rebounding is keeping them in the game right now.
Okay, now they come out of that zone. They play man-to-man. Here's where they go to that offense where they want to put the ball to the floor. Aaron, they want to attack the basket, Aaron.
Dick, I have to tell you, John Calipari told me yesterday, last night was the very first time he has watched last year's game against Tennessee. He said he did not have the stomach to do it. He said two things in that game. One, Chris Lofton was amazing, as we've mentioned, and one thing he stressed all day in practice yesterday, you have got to get on Lofton body to body. If you do that, that will bother him, and Dan, that is what has happened tonight.
Duke Cruz the foul, Aaron. Lofton came to the scorer's table, then sat back down. He single-handedly destroyed the Tigers a year ago in Knoxville, and now here comes one of the all-time great shooters in college basketball back into the game.
Well, you know, he's destroyed a lot of people with his ability to shoot the three. Kentucky said no to him coming out of high school. He went to Tennessee, and what a career. I mean, he's going to be one of the all-time greats ever to play at Tennessee.
Was in a real shooting slump earlier this year after the Kentucky loss. Broke out of it and has been shooting about 50% from beyond the arc the last several weeks.
He goes the free throw line. Yep. Remember, they're last in Division One, 328. I think ultimately that hurts. I don't know. I know last year they shot well in the tournament, went to the Elite Eight. I think psychologically that's going to bother you as a coach.
Last year they shot 61% from the field during the season, but then 71% in the tournament. Douglas Roberts. It rattles out the long rebound right back to him.
Well, Smith did a great job not letting him get to the basket.
How about Derrick Rose? Almost unstoppable.
He's so uncanny, so unique. I think he and Eric Gordon and Love have certainly lived up to all the buildup coming out of high school.
Nice look inside. Tyler Smith with the finish.
Great. Old art of moving without the basketball, one of the lost arts in the game.
First field goal in 4 minutes for the Vols brings them back within 5.
You know, everybody talks about the schedule being a little bit, you know, weak. And certainly in Conference USA, you don't face the major clubs you face in the Big East, etc. But I think Houston and UAB still have a chance to get in the Big Dance.
UAB almost beating Memphis a week ago, losing by a point. Another Memphis turnover.
Robert Davids having a great year for UAB, former Indiana Hoosier.
Howell open in the corner, and the fifth-year senior misses the three. 3. ABC is your NBA Sunday destination. NBA action returns to ABC tomorrow as the Pistons take on Shaquille O'Neal and the Phoenix Suns beginning at 2 o'clock Eastern time. The third game for the Suns with Shaq in the middle. Coverage begins at 2 with GMC NBA countdown.
He looks like he's committed now, dedicating himself to really want to have a good year. You know, Memphis has had only 5 games decided by single figures. UAB by 1, USC 4 in overtime. UTEP, Gonzaga, and Houston.
A foul away from the ball goes against Memphis.
You know, Jerry Tarkanian, I know, has told me several times that his club that went unblemished in 91, he thinks a loss might have helped them. They would never, ever challenge. I think the closest game, he said, was like about 9.
John Calipari, not sure of that call. It goes on Dorsey, Dick. It's his second, and with 4 minutes left in the half, he sits down.
Yeah, Dorsey's so valuable because he's the one dominating rebounder they have.
And a great shot blocker. Reigning CUSA Defensive Player of the Year.
See, they can attack inside without Dorsey on the floor.
Cruz misses the jump hook. They thought they had lost him for the season, but back from a heart ailment that was not as serious as was originally thought.
And the Tennessee foul will go against Juwan Smith. Emotion in the building from the moment the fans began filing in. And one of the big reasons, Dick, the coaches have as much emotion as anybody here tonight.
Oh, they're so passionate. They really care. Look at his sense of passion. Get in the game.
Perfection is so special because it's hard to come by. When you realize that it's something that nobody had ever done, you're very, very proud of that accomplishment.
Very difficult to go undefeated. I think you have to have great players, great coaching, and you also have to be a little bit lucky.
There's nothing like the culmination of a perfect championship season. You look around and your guys are right there and all your teammates, and you know, now that was a job well done.
That's been a job well done by the Memphis Tigers thus far, 26-0, the last team to go through the regular season undefeated. St. Joe's lost to the A-10 tournament. UNLV got all the way to the Final Four before losing back in 91, and the last team to run the table, the 1976 Indiana Hoosiers.
You know, they were talking about that UNLV team at that time, maybe being one of the greatest teams of all time. Then they ran into Bob Hurley, who made a dramatic three, lost in the semifinal. They had beaten Duke the year prior by 30 in the NCAA championship. And Duke wins that game and goes on and wins the national title.
Chris Douglas Roberts misses the front end.
See, there it is, that free throw line.
Yep, Tennessee's not good, but Memphis is dismal.
Well, it keeps you in the game. I think if you're Bruce Pearl with Lofton with 0 points, and the way Memphis has shot the three, that they can go in at halftime with a chance to win, I think they're very fortunate.
Nowhere for Chisholm to go, so he tries the reverse, misses it. It'll be Memphis ball as we check in with Aaron Andrews.
Dan, in talking about perfection, you know, all NFL season, John Calipari was using the New England Patriots as an example, showing his team, hey, look how they're dealing with distractions, with the media, with what the critics are saying. Of course, up until the Super Bowl, he was able to use that as an example. The guys told me yesterday he doesn't use them anymore, but Calipari telling me he's able to use that lesson to his team. He thinks in the end the media and the distractions got to the Pats. Memphis player Antonio Anderson, who is from Massachusetts, says, yeah, coach didn't bring it up after the Super Bowl victory, and quite frankly, Anderson's still trying to get over the loss himself.
Well, both of these coaches master motivators.
Yeah, they really are. They really work on that point of the game. Such a vital point. I think also what makes them special is they have the unique ability, which is needed today, to really be able to communicate with the modern-day athlete. They really have a way where the players respond to them in a positive fashion.
The foul on Lamar Smith, his second. Douglas Roberts. Back to the line, two shots now, 10 team fouls on Tennessee.
You know, when you got a resume and you're winning, 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 that really makes your words that much more effective.
Lofton back in, and Bruce Pearl pulled him out when they were on defense, put him back in on offense, wants to have him in there when he can, but doesn't want him to pick up his third foul here in the first half. Rashidi R, the junior out of Detroit, having a sensational season.
Absolutely.
Averaging almost 18 points per game, shooting 56% from the floor. Let's see if the balls can get Lofton a look. Andre Allen is on him right now, and Allen is a pit bull.
He's right up in his face, not going to give him any open look for that three.
Call for the foul.
He's not going to give him an open look for the three. You know, you think about the SEC. Obviously, this year, it is not vintage SEC. It runs in cycles. It is not the kind of year where you got dominant teams. In fact, I think Kentucky, I know some people disagree with me, because they had those losses early. I think Kentucky's going to get in the NCAA tournament. I think they're going to play themselves in and another good win today. They beat Tennessee. They beat Vanderbilt.
Kentucky's at Tennessee in about a week and a half. Lofton at the line, he'll knock it down. Judgment of Week presented by Jockey is on ESPN at 7 Eastern on a Monday. Marquette taking on Villanova. The Wildcats upset UConn today, and then Texas against Kansas State at a meeting of ranked teams out of the Big 12. That is Monday at 9 Eastern here on ESPN.
Well, Lofton got his first point, had 34 last year. You mentioned the Big 12. Michael Beasley will see him next week. Rock Chalk Jayhawks, man, love that place down in Lawrence.
Ooh, travel on Allen, he knew it.
They had that stunning loss today to Oklahoma State.
And Oklahoma State, that is starting to play better now, has won 4 out of 5 the Cowboys have.
I know you don't care, but I'm going to tell you anyway. I think my number one seeds, when it's all said and done, there's a lot of basketball we played yet.
I think you're going to have UCLA in there. I think you're going to have North Carolina. I think you're going to have Tennessee, and you're going to have Memphis.
No Kansas with that loss today. Chisholm knocks down a three, and Tennessee is right back in it.
You know, he can shoot threes. He has taken 63 coming into this game. Remember, Memphis got a 47-game win streak. BYU's 45, and Notre Dame is 35. 35 current home court win streak.
The Irish somewhat quietly playing some great basketball right now with the probable Big East player of the year, Luke Herangode.
Oh, I think that's a lot. Tennessee's won 30 in a row, and next week will be in Rock Chalk General Land and won 22 in a row.
Good save by Chisholm. What an effort there.
They push the ball. They run that ball up the floor. That's their style.
Chisholm feeling it. The tip up, but no, and there's a push. Good call.
Absolutely.
I don't know what Jeff Robinson's complaining about, because that was an easy call.
It was a very easy call. A guy with one eye like me could see that, baby.
Scattered orange here amongst all the blue at FedEx Forum. The Vols have never been ranked this high in the history of the program. It's the best start in program history, and they lead the SEC in so many categories, and they're averaging about 8,000 more in attendance than they used to. They got a new practice facility. They've remodeled phase one at Thompson Bowling Arena. I mean, Bruce Pearl's got it going on.
He's got it going, but also, what about Pat Summitt?
Yeah.
Gee, you talk about winning seven national titles. I can't wait. As you know, we're honoring Pat on May 16th over in Sarasota, Florida, along with Bob Knight, honoring both. There's only a couple hundred tickets left. Anybody wants to join us? Bruce Pearl is coming. John Calipari's coming. Got a call. Billy Donovan is coming. Tom Izzo's coming.
You're going to need some more microphones or a bigger podium.
It's going to be unbelievable. Anybody wants to go, just go to my website, BigVitalOnline.com, or call 1-800-4-JIMMY-V. And remember, all the money we raise is going to go to help kids battling cancer.
6-0 run for the Vols. Lofton on the bench has not made a field goal, has had some foul trouble. Donnell Mack a miss. Rose taps it back out. Rose inside the arc. Soft touch.
He's shooting well tonight.
Yeah.
What a future he has. The sky is unlimited. He's going to be such a talented player at the next level in transition. A falling back, look at this. And a little passive defensively, so a little soft.
Chisholm down on the post. We're into the final minute of the first half. Off the glass and good. He's had some big minutes here down the stretch.
He's showing inside-outside ability. I think Tennessee's got to be very happy with where they're sitting right now after the way Memphis was on fire early with those threes.
A team that is 7-2 in true road games this year. Rose for three. And Tennessee can take the lead. They can hold it if they want to. Tab. And now Memphis and Rose sees the clock, and the Tigers will hold for the last shot.
You know, Chisholm really has come up big here late in this half to keep them where they're at. Remember, baby, number one at stake, 47 in a row at home at stake. Can Memphis go undefeated in the regular season?
Robinson steps into the three. They got 4 seconds. Prince. Entertaining first half comes to a close.
Yeah, it really has been. I mean, it hasn't been pure in terms of the play, been a little sloppy, but you've seen some three-point shooting, you've seen a lot of good athleticism, and most of all, a lot of passion.
A one-point game. Aaron Anders is with Bruce Pearl.
All right, well, Coach, what has Memphis done to Chris Lofton in the first half?
Hold him. Drape him like this.
Okay.
Right?
All right.
They're doing a good job of making his touches difficult. What a start to the game, huh? That's nuts, the way both teams are shooting the ball. They can't beat us from three all night long. They just can't. I thought offensively, we were impatient. Running was good early, but then after they were back, we just took a boatload of bad shots. We're fortunate to only be down one.
How are you in this? The fact that they were just draining threes left and right.
Because we don't panic. We're poised. And, you know, got some good players, too.
All right, Bruce, thank you.
Thanks.
Looking forward to the second half. It's halftime here at ESPN Saturday primetime game for the FedEx Forum. A one-point lead for Memphis. Coming up in the UPS halftime report, Kansas loses at Oklahoma State. UCLA with a comeback win in Indiana, playing without Kelvin Sampson. Next, Reese, Hubert, Digger, and Jay.
This is the UPS halftime report.
So has it been everything it was advertised to be? The freshman, Derrick Rose, got Memphis off to a great start. 10 points in the first half, but Tennessee is down just by one at the break, 35-34. Reese Davis along with Hubert Davis, Digger Phelps, Jay Billis. Memphis on fire from three-point land. They've already hit 8 of them on the night. Yeah. Tennessee's winning the rebounding battle. Everything seems to be turned upside down. You like the position the Volunteers are in right now.
They have to feel very good to be in this position, only down by one here at halftime, because they haven't played particularly well. But you really have to compliment Memphis defensively on Chris Lofton. They've only held them to 1 point, one field goal attempt. Antonio Anderson and Andre Allen have been fantastic guarding him in the first half.
Well, if you're Bruce Pearl and you say we're only down one and Chris Lofton no field goals, let's get it done the second half. I thought, Reese and I are talking to each other during the first half, I thought, Jay, both teams got tired at the 8-minute mark because of all the energy and the adrenaline going, and they just were exhausted and they had a little low in that first half.
Yeah, I think that's part of it. And I think Tennessee's done a really good job of pushing the ball up the court, and it's Tennessee who's beating Memphis off the dribble. Memphis got to do a better job of guarding the ball, and they also have to do a better job on their defensive glass, because it was Tennessee who was getting those second shots. And both teams have to do a better job of shot selection. I thought they pulled the trigger a little too early on some shots.
You don't like that Sean Taggart three or Jeff Robinson?
Hey, how about Jeff Robinson? He had a couple in the first half. He'd only made three all year. He was 3 out of 20. Memphis was shooting it from everywhere. We've got a one-point game at the break. The other dominant story in college basketball over the past week, the departure of Kelvin Sampson from Indiana. Dan Dockich taking over as the Hoosiers on the road against Northwestern. You see the Indiana players supporting Sampson, wearing his initials on their shoes. Indiana was sluggish, turned it over 9 times in the first half. Michael Thompson finishing. Under 2 minutes to go, Indiana in the first half. Indiana was down by 4, Jordan Crawford.
Crawford hits a big three, but Bissett as well as White combined for 33 points with about 8 minutes to go in the first half.
Armand Bassett, one of the better perimeter shooters in the Big Ten, takes it all the way to the bucket, and Indiana's in a fight with Northwestern right now. They're tied with under 4 minutes to go in the game, 73-73. Bassett with 22 points. Northwestern has yet to win a Big Ten game this year. Michigan State blows out Iowa 66-52. Raymar Morgan was perfect, hit all 6 of his field goals and all 4 of his free throws. Kansas and Oklahoma State, folks have been playing better. Darnell Jackson working inside, JB.
Well, Darnell Jackson did a good job in this game with exception of the turnovers. He had 16 points, 10 rebounds, but 5 turnovers, 21 turnovers for Kansas overall.
Byron Eaton hit 16 of 18 free throws. He missed one late, but he made one to give Oklahoma State a 1-point lead. And now Kansas trying to get off the winner and didn't get much done.
No, you got to get a better shot. This one by Brandon Rush, you probably should have pulled the trigger, but they got to get to the rim when they're down only one. Got to get a better shot.
61-60. Oklahoma State rushing the floor, playing much better right now. Oh, just another night at the office for Michael Beasley, the freshman. Another 40-10 night, 42-11, but Kansas State is trailing Baylor by 4.
Well, this is a must game for Baylor. They've been 1-6 since that 5 overtime win against Texas A&M. They need to get this game to have any hope of getting to the NCAA tournament.
And Texas took care of Oklahoma, meaning that the Longhorns have moved atop the Big 12. They are a game up on Kansas, and of course they won the head-to-head meeting as well. Oregon and UCLA, second half, Bruins down by 8. At one point, the Bruins had trailed by 11. Russell Westbrook.
Well, I think he changed the game on this play. He twisted his ankle a couple plays before. His ability to come on a fast break and dunk over these guys really got them going defensively, and that's what turned the game around.
He had 16 points. UCLA able to close the game on a 38-17 run. Collison, Westbrook, the flush on the other end. Bruins took the lead and then pulled away. How about Kevin Love? He can throw an outlet pass. Collison with the stuff. Bruins win it by double figures, 75-65. They are 24-3. Still to come on the UPS Halftime Report, UConn won 10 in a row. We'll show you how the streak came to an end.
Delivered by UPS. What can Brown do for you?
Talking about, but still talk. Gotta love how it's on now, but on me. Oh,
passion, poise, and purpose. Passion, poise, and purpose allow us to win on the road. We're going to play with passion, but we're going to have poise when they make their runs, poise when they block shots, poise when they talk to us, poise when it gets elevated a little bit. Because everything we do with a purpose. The way we guard, the way we rebound, the way we fast break, and the way we execute.
Welcome back to ESPN Saturday Night Primetime, presented by DirecTV inside FedEx Forum here in Memphis. The toughest ticket in town, to say the least. Number one Memphis, number two Tennessee. A one-point game as we go to the second half. Passion, poise, and purpose. Priscilla, Peyton, and Penny. It's the P's here all night long. What's going to decide this game in the second half?
He forgot about points. You got to talk about points as well.
Yeah.
I tell you this, I think that he's in great shape to only be down one like he has been here in his first half, especially the way they shot threes. Memphis cannot win this game exclusively going to the three. They got to get to the basket, get some transition layups, some inside play. They're not going to win the game just firing all kinds of threes. Tennessee wants them to do that.
Aaron Andrews had a chance to visit with the Memphis staff to find out some adjustments for the second half.
Dan, head coach John Calipari told me he loved the intensity of his team in the first half. He said he didn't like the fact he had to stop the game less than a minute in to remind them they were being out-hustled. But he said after I reminded them, he loved how gritty and physical they were. He wants to see that in the second half. He said the way his team will be able to pull it out in the second half is all in Robert Dozier and Joey Dorsey's hands. They have to get inside, they have to get to the loose balls, and they have to rebound the ball.
Well, Aaron Dozier played only 4 minutes of foul trouble in the first half. Lofton played 10, had only 1 point. He's their leading scorer, a great shooter. And Memphis Dick started off the night 7 of 11 from three, then went 1 of 9 the rest of the half.
Well, you know, basically, they've not been a good shooting team all year from the perimeter. And I think Tennessee's philosophy allowing them to shoot the three has really been, to me, I think a smart play, even though they were effective early.
Dorsey the miss, the rebound to Chisholm. The biggest lead of the game was Memphis by 7 with about 5 minutes to go in the first half.
You know, Memphis goes 8 for 20, as you say, from the three. They've only made 3 baskets in terms of 2-point baskets.
And of the 11 baskets they've got, Derrick Rose has made 4 of them and assisted on 4 others.
He's been involved in 8 of the 11. You expect that from the star point guard.
Tyler Smith and the Vols lead. Their first lead since 11-9, less than 3 minutes into the game.
See, I think offensively you got to have balance. You got to have the perimeter three, but you're also going to have scoring on the interior as well.
Tyler Smith now with 11. Derrick Rose leads Memphis with 10. Douglas Roberts wide open, short on the three.
They're going to allow him to shoot that three all night, Dan.
Ramar Smith with a burst of speed. And the foul will be before the basket.
They're going to wave the goal off.
A look at the first half stats here tonight. These two teams set a torrid pace offensively the first 6 minutes or so. Then they both cooled off. Maybe the biggest surprise, Dick, the points in the paint, 16-2 for Tennessee.
Yeah, Tennessee dominated the inside. Also a big surprise to me is the way they've been able to contain Lofton.
Lofton has attempted just one shot, has 1 point in the game.
They made a decision to body up on him to really not give him any good looks from the perimeter.
Rose surrounded.
You got to try to close off that driving angle from the wall. See, they try to get you one-on-one.
Dozier, there's the guy Aaron was talking about that John Calipari mentioned to her.
He's long and lean. He's very athletic.
6'9 junior out of Lithonia, Georgia, averaging better than 10 points, 7 rebounds per game.
He's also added 20 pounds to his frame.
Lofton can't get free for a shot, Dick.
No, they're right up in his face. Yeah. They're giving him no looks whatsoever.
Chisholm for three.
Are you serious? I mean, are you serious? As Timmy D would say, are the banks open, baby? Are they open here in Memphis?
John Calipari couldn't believe it. Turned his back on the play after it happened.
That's a bad sign for Memphis.
And it'll be knocked out of bounds, Tennessee ball.
I mean, here you are in transition and they're trying to play for the three rather than a layup. Look at Chisholm right now. I mean, are you kidding? Think he called that? You think he called it? He said, I can shoot the three. Look at the smile on his face. He said, I want to be big man on campus when we go back to Knoxville.
Chisholm, a sophomore out of Jackson, Tennessee, a high school teammate of Memphis's Willie Kemp.
Yeah, Willie Kemp now coming off the bench. Hasn't been a factor here tonight.
Lamar Smith turns the corner off the glass, in and out.
I tell you, those athletes really break you down with the dribble, the Smith guys. Lamar, Juwan.
Again, Ramar, Juwan, Tyler, all Smiths, none of them related, all of them starters for this Tennessee team as Andre Allen comes back in and Derrick Rose sits down early in the second half.
You know, Juwan is really an underrated defensive player, very solid defensively.
Averages, or last year averaged, better than two steals per game. Timeout taken by the Vols, unable to get the ball in.
You know what's really a key for these clubs, why they're successful? They're very unselfish, just like the Gators were last year, winning back-to-back national titles.
And this ESPN telecast is available in shimmering high definition on ESPN HD, presented by Olivia, Dan Schulman, Dick Vitale, Aaron Andrews, the Game Day Gang, all here inside FedEx Forum in Memphis. Number one Tigers, number two Vols. The last six times that number one and number two have met, five of those six times, Dick, number two has won, including Ohio State over Wisconsin a year ago.
Well, you know, number two, she's got a chip on her shoulder. Ohio State won that one-point game over Wisconsin.
Dozier with a block.
Dozier's so long, lean, and athletic.
Allen cannot finish at the other end. The pace quickening again. Lofted all the way. Dozier with another block. And a great save by Antonio Anderson.
You want to get a good shot on his possession.
Douglas Roberts short. Rebound Chisholm. Up and down they go.
Run, baby, run.
Juwan Smith knocked out of bounds. Tennessee ball.
You know, it's great to see clubs running up and down the floor, not so structured, playing that half-court game, scoring 40 points with a three-point shot. And with the shot clock, sometimes it's so boring.
Tennessee
really is
averaging about 84 points per game. Memphis about 81.
You know, Lofton has a chance. He needs 27 points to become a 2,000-point scorer. Yeah. Allen Houston, Grunfeld, Tony White, Reggie Johnson, and Dale Ellis.
You know, they've got some tradition. Allen Houston, Dale Ellis was a Vol. You talked about
Bernie.
I mean, just great players. But this is the highest ranking that Tennessee basketball, men's basketball, has ever had.
They've never been number one in 100 years. They could have that happen tonight.
Lamar Smith, and the follow not there. Tennessee runs down the loose ball again.
I'd hustle them, I'd scrap them. Yeah.
And hurt is Chisholm. Chisholm is down. Wayne Chisholm looked like it might have been an ankle that got rolled as he spun and made that pass. And he has been a key contributor for the Volunteers tonight.
That would be a major, major loss for them. Because really on the interior, they're limited in the number of big people they have.
Watch him spin. And right there, got that right foot caught underneath him. You might get a better view here.
He looks okay the way he's walking. I mean, a slight limp.
Wow. Could be the ankle or the knee. Something in the right leg, obviously, as Chisholm gets up and is trying to walk it off. Judgment Week presented by Jockey is on ESPN. It's 7 Eastern on a Monday night. Number 24, Marquette, taking on a Villanova team that beat UConn today. And then a great-looking game out of the Big 12, Texas, against Kansas State. Texas, an easy winner over Oklahoma today. Damian James with a double-double. A foul against Memphis.
Mentioned Kansas State. Michael Beasley having another monster game today. They're struggling a little bit against Baylor, but he's over the 40 mark.
Foul on Douglas Roberts. Chisholm out, and Duke Cruz is back into the game to take his place. Prince, no. Rebound Dorsey.
He's such a wide body.
Chisholm, by the way, waved off the trainer. Says he's
what a play. What a play by Derrick Rose. I mean, just terrific. What I like about him, he doesn't seem to force shots. He plays unselfishly, plays to win.
Got a dozen right now, the high score in the game, and we're tied at 39.
Got away from Illinois. He's really struggling this year.
Look at the hustle by Dorsey hitting the floor.
You better hustle, number one, number two. You don't hustle here, there's something wrong with you.
A little hustle and a whole lot of talent, Dickie V.
That's talent right there. Look at an acrobatic shot, putting it off the glass, protects the ball.
A Scott Baylor, an amazing story. Back to Indiana. Dan Dockich, the interim head coach, will be there the rest of the season. Who do you envision, Dockich or otherwise, being their coach next
year? Well, you know, they're a little let down tonight. They didn't practice. The kids are emotional over the Kelvin Sampson scenario. However, they do survive. If I were the athletic director, listen to me, I'll tell you who I'd go after. I would hire, after he's an interim, Dan Dockich, a guy that's got a clean record, no problems, NCAA, a winner, and available. Mike Montgomery, the former Stanford coach, would be an ideal guy in Hoosier country. He would be perfect.
So you don't need to go inside the family. You just want a coach with a proven track record. Howell, long on the three.
Well, the first guy I would hire, and they're not going to hire him, is Robert Montgomery Knight. I'd bring him back to Bloomington. You talk about excitement, and he's got at least 10 years left in coaching. If I were an AD somewhere, South Carolina, I'd give a call to Mr. Knight.
Rose, and a block. What a defensive play by J.P. Prince.
He's got those long arms, Prince. Nice cut without the ball.
Prince runs the floor and jams. The transfer out of Arizona had a serious, serious health issue. Wisdom teeth taken out, an infection developed, lost a lot of weight in an induced coma, has gradually gotten stronger and healthier, and now is back in his home state of Tennessee. He's actually from White Station High School right here in Memphis.
You know, he's really such an asset coming off the bench. Look how he cuts without the ball right down the gut. Nobody rotates over. Poor job defensively finding your man. Communications amassed. Prince, a valuable guy off the bench.
Again, Tennessee, a very deep team. Loft and foul trouble in the first half. Chisholm, an injury here in the second half, but they play on and they lead on the road against number one. The follow is there for Prince again. What a great play.
I tell you, he's been a real plus off the bench.
Rebounding, Dick, is a huge story. Memphis, statistically, a much better rebounding team than Tennessee. But right now, the Vols are crushing them on the glass, and Prince has two more.
Timeout and a T.O., baby. Oh, Mr. Calipari needs this timeout. The Vols are explosive in transition.
The 32nd timeout.
They have weathered a couple of storms here tonight. Bruce Pearl talked about the poise, and they're executing right now.
Well, they weathered the storm early. 7-for-11 shooting threes. Take a look at Prince. I mean, he's really such an asset. There he is with the offensive rebound. Ivan on the floor. Look at that hustle. What a great play right there to get that loose ball. And the jam. Aaron, I'll tell you, it's run, baby, run by the Vols.
It certainly is. J.P. Prince, as Dan mentioned, grew up Memphis fan, was a ball boy, roamed the sidelines forever at the Pyramid when his father, John, was an assistant under Larry Finch. He says everyone in Memphis knew who he was because he's been playing in front of them since he was in second grade. And you know, it was interesting. Bruce Pearl had mentioned he was maybe going to talk to J.P. about before the game. He was worried about him being a little too emotional. I can tell you right now, him and Joey Dorsey just had a few words. It is definitely emotional out there.
I tell you, like his cousin is so underrated nice with shot. The Pistons.
Yep.
Oh, a really underrated player.
You'll see him tomorrow against Shaq, Nash, and the Suns on ABC. When they need a bucket, who do they go to? CDR.
Remember, they were down 7 with a minute and 22 last Saturday, and Chris Douglas Roberts wouldn't let them lose.
What do you think Bruce Pearl would say as Lofton launches, still has not made a field goal? Almost 6 minutes into the second half, and they're winning on the road.
He was amazing. Absolutely amazing.
Held ball. It'll stay with Tennessee.
I'll tell you, Mike Hamilton, the fine athletic director of Tennessee, made a great hire when he went after Bruce Pearl, who really got the great opportunity with the success at University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee.
And before that, a protege of Tom Davis, an assistant at BC, Stanford, Iowa. Got his first head coaching job as Prince commits the foul at D2 Southern Indiana, won a national championship there, went to Wisconsin and Milwaukee, had tremendous success there, got his school into the Sweet 16, among others that he beat, Alabama in that NCAA tournament, and then took over Tennessee 3 years ago, 70-21 and ranked second in the nation.
So the message is loud and clear to some of those mid-major schools. If you win and get to the Sweet 16, you become a hot commodity.
Sure do.
With a lot of jobs that will be opening up.
Douglas Roberts from the baseline. Little push shot from 12 feet.
I tell you, that guy's got a winner's mentality. He makes big plays whenever they're struggling.
Nickname is Buckets, and we see why. Chisholm back into the game, and he turns it over.
I think Memphis needs some scoring inside out of Dozier and also out of Dorsey as you watch the mid-range jump shot by CDR.
Averaging 18 a game, better than 27 a game his last three, a dozen tonight.
Trying to get him one-on-one, trying to get him isolated.
Anderson for three. Memphis started the game 7 of 11 from three-point range. They are 1 of 11 since. Powell can't turn the corner on Andre Allen.
And that's the reason why Bruce Pearl has said we're going to let him try to beat us from the perimeter.
Nice cut by Lofton. His first field goal of the night.
And what a way. Rather than the three, cuts without the basketball. I tell you, they're doing a great job with their motion offensively, moving without the ball.
Tennessee by four, the number two Volunteers. If they win tonight, they'll go to number one for the first time in program history. And Douglas Roberts travels.
Remember that stake here to let you people again remember this. Memphis has won 47 in a row at home.
And Jordan Howe, I'm sorry, Dick, comes up limping, and he's going to have to leave the game. Another injured Tennessee player.
Back in the game, Tennessee number 30, J.P. Prince.
Prince back in with three fouls.
47 in a row, the longest win streak at home. 26-0, the only unbeaten team. Number one. These are all the numbers that are at stake.
And bragging rights for the rest of their lives in the state of Tennessee. Lofton, a wild shot. And a foul. Ramar Smith.
George Lapidus, who's really a guy, and started talk radio here. Ron Higgins wrote an article about him, the fine writer here in Memphis. George Lapidus said this is the third biggest game ever in Memphis basketball history. 1957, when they played Bradley in the NCAA NIT championship, and then they played UCLA in 73 for the national championship, and now this game here.
Number one against number two, just the fifth time ever two teams from the same state have been ranked one and two and played one another. Twice Duke against Carolina, twice Cincinnati against Ohio State back in the early 60s. As both coaches have said, this is the kind of atmosphere, game, hype, normally reserved for a game between, say, Kentucky and Louisville, or a couple of Indiana schools, or a couple of North Carolina schools. But Tennessee, as good a state in college basketball as there's been this season. Timeout taken by Memphis. It may be just one game, but you wouldn't know that. It's not just any other game when you look at the faces of these coaches. Hey, ABC is your NBA Sunday destination. You talked about Tayshaun Prince. It'll be Prince and the Pistons taking on Nash, Shaq, and the Suns. Coverage begins at 2 Eastern tomorrow with GMC NBA Countdown, and then the tip-off at 2:30 Eastern tomorrow on ABC.
Certainly have had a tough week when you talk about the Suns playing the likes of the Lakers, the Celtics, and now the Pistons.
Third game for Shaq. Here's what he's done in the first two. Looks pretty healthy. Looks pretty spry. He's put up some good numbers so far.
Yeah, he's really playing with a lot of enthusiasm and spirit. You know, 85 also, don't forget about the fact that the Final Four, you have three Big East teams, and they were there, Memphis, the year that Villanova, Willie Massimino pitched that Don Lawson perfect game
right
against the Hoyas at Georgetown.
Memphis will try to get it in again. The lob inside for Dorsey. Banging away inside, and it's rejected. I think it was Prince who came over as the help defender.
I tell you, they're really staying nose to nose with Dorsey. Not getting intimidated. Lofton not getting any looks from the trifecta at all.
Dorsey, no field goals, just 1 point. Now, granted, he's much more of a factor defensively, but you'd like a little offense on the inside from him.
He only had two against Tennessee last year. Out of foul trouble, 13 rebounds.
Dozier's only made one shot. Taggart's only made one shot. Their bigs are not doing a lot offensively. There's a three for Chisholm.
I'll tell you, they're playing with a lot of confidence, and I'll tell you something else they've done. They've really quieted this crowd a little bit. Crowd was a lot more emotional early in this game.
Biggest lead of the night for the Vols. Rose. It won't drop it. We've got a foul. And it's going against Prince, I believe. If it is, it's his fourth. We've got a timeout on the floor, and Tennessee has played great here in the second half in an intense affair. Number two trying to beat number one, and they're up by seven. Well, Scott, here in Memphis right now, number one is trailing number two by seven. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. Tennessee played very well here in the second half. And ESPN Sports Nation poll, Dick, who's going to win this game, Memphis or Tennessee? Look at the results nationally, and then look at the results within the state of Tennessee and how different they are.
Wow, yeah, it's certainly different. I mean, it looks like we're looking at some of the primaries right now. I mean, where's the name? Obama and Clinton. I tell you, whoever wins this game is going to own this state. Hey, the difference in this game, I think, rebounding, when you look at Tennessee, 16 offensive rebounds to only six. When you're offensively rebounding, that means you're playing aggressive basketball. Block shots, force steals, deflections, that means you're playing aggressive basketball.
By the way, the last foul not on Prince, so he's still got three. Brian Williams gets the foul, his first, as we go to Aaron.
Dan, I was just listening to John Calipari's huddle, and he was telling his team, we're fine, we're okay, but he did call out Robert Dozier in that huddle. He told him, look, the entire nation is watching. Do something, will ya? I don't care if you break your hand. Get in there, get a ball, do something in the paint, we need ya.
He doesn't care if he breaks his hand. Better call my son-in-law, who's a hand specialist.
Dozier, 4 points, one rebound tonight. Lofton,
bad shot.
Rebound Rose.
Bad shot by the veteran player.
Anderson, followed by Dozier.
That's Memphis basketball. Good timeout by John Calipari. They come back, they get four straight points. John Calipari knows how to win as well. You got two guys here that really understand how to get the most out of people.
And Robert Dozier out of the doghouse, running the floor, laying it in. He's got six. Tigers back within three.
Well, Aaron said that John gave him an ultimatum.
Yep. The old do something, why don't you? Both coaches can use the bench as a motivator. They're both so deep.
Another offensive rebound.
They're 17th offensive rebound for the Bulls.
I watch Dozier going to get out of transition along with Mr. Rose. He kicks it to him. He says, coach, coach, do you like the more offensive rebound right there, coach?
Well, Dozier gets in on the action. Brian Williams goes to the line now for Tennessee. A young man, Dick, who in the last 2 years has lost over 100 pounds. He is 6'10", 267 out of the Bronx. He used to weigh 374 pounds.
Why didn't Coach Fulmer get him as an offensive tackle?
And a guard.
And a center.
Giving him some minutes. He'll get 6-8 minutes a game. A space heater on the inside, misses the free throws, and he's upset with himself.
See, now execution out of the half-court game becomes important. That's another vital part when you get into the NCAA tournament. The game becomes more half-court oriented.
Good help on Rose. The kick to a wide-open Mack.
That's his emotionally specialty. That's why he's on the floor to shoot the three.
Well, you can't say enough about Tennessee's rebounding. That was expected to be a weakness for them in this game.
Especially with Dorsey, Dozier, and Taggart. They out-rebound their opponents by better than eight when you talk it.
Yes.
Memphis, so one of the rules he had on the blackboard before the game, he said plus 10 on the rebounds is what we want.
And Bruce Pearl also wrote, rebound like your life depended on it. And I think the Bulls have done that tonight.
Wait a minute, he said that because he told me that the game Tuesday's more important against Vanderbilt.
You fell for that old trick,
gee,
huh?
I fell for, you know, it is statistically, there's no question when you talk about how important that game is in the SEC. However, when you talk bragging rights, number one, trying to beat a team that's undefeated, it's special.
Douglas Roberts back in. See if he can ignite them offensively. Jawan Smith, three early threes in this game. three senior guards on the floor right now for the Vols. How important is that in hostile territory?
Well, General Bowles has done a great job, I think, in hostile territory, really silencing the crowd, keeping the emotion in the crowd, giving them that adrenaline and that edge.
The second half was the first time I was able to hear you tonight, actually. It's been so noisy in here.
Hey, Beale Street was rocking and rolling really early. Can you imagine what it would be like if they were to win?
Didn't it feel like it was a football weekend?
Exactly.
Because people were out on the street hours before the game as Tyler Smith will go to the line. Taggart is going back in.
Unselfish play.
Number four on Dorsey.
The entire town has been really captivated by the Memphis basketball program. It's been such a nightmare and a struggle with the Grizzlies. 92-8 in his last 3 years.
Dick, remember Dorsey fouled out in the loss last year in Knoxville, played only 15 minutes.
There goes the Brooks again. Yeah. I mean, both these clubs, really a nightmare at the free throw line, and you can't understand why. They do all kinds of drills. It's a matter of mental preparation as well as the physical end of it.
Smith, 72% on the season.
He's one of the better shooters.
Knocks one down after three consecutive misses. Dorsey sitting down with four fouls.
That could be big as we talk because he's their one key guy inside.
This loft in the back to the bench for the Vols. Douglas Roberts for three.
They try to isolate Roberts. They really push the ball up the court.
Prince with the nifty reverse.
He's a left-handed player. He made that with his right hand. He's been absolutely sensational off the bench. He has been a roll-aid specialist coming off that bench.
Scoreless at the half. 8 points, Dick, here in the second half.
I guess Peyton's on cloud nine right now. I know Kenny Chesney is down there. He's saying right now, his number one song at one time, he's saying, don't blink, baby, don't blink.
Well, if the Vols could win this game, blink and they'll be number one for the first time in program history.
They also won 22 games, four different occasions. If they win tonight, that'll be 25, the second most in one season in school history.
Beat a number one South Carolina back in 1969. Things are getting bigger and better for these Vols by the year. They're 24-2, 11-1 in the SEC, looking for their first outright SEC championship since 1967.
And I'll tell you one thing, they better lace them up, Kentucky, when they go to Tennessee in that revenge matchup, because Kentucky put the hurt on them up there in Lexington.
And they go to Vandy Tuesday night on ESPN. They still got to go to Gainesville as well. Rose. Good strength by Rose to muscle that shot up, and he's rewarded with a couple of free throws.
Yeah, you mentioned Gainesville. Billy Donovan lost so much when you think about the three guys in the top nine of the NBA draft with Nolan, Horford, and Brewer. And yet his club, I know people will say, well, they haven't had a big, big win. They won 20 games with a team that is completely, basically new.
And think of how good they could be next year. Rose misses a free throw. The streak's at stake for the Tigers tonight. 26-0 in the season, 45 consecutive regular season wins, 47 consecutive wins here at home.
See, my gut feeling is even if they're going to lose this game, to me, they don't lose a number one seed on a loss to a team like Tennessee.
Just one timeout remaining for Memphis, 9 minutes to go. Remember, John Calipari used one 35 seconds into the game, but he has been forced to, unhappy with his team's effort at times.
I'll tell you the difference in this game. The difference maker has been Prince. Prince has really been a difference off that bench.
Four buckets here in the second half for J.P. Prince. Chisholm has slipped and turned it over.
He won. Shuffle those feet.
Not to belabor the point, but again, Chris Lofton, the reigning SEC player of the year, a guy who scored 34 against Memphis last year, is 1 of 7, has 3 points, and Tennessee is up 6. Lofton on the bench.
That shows you that they got more than Mr. Lofton. It shows that they got quite a few good players.
Well, the two transfers, J.P. Prince and Tyler Smith, we can see how important they have been tonight.
There's a little man-to-man defense right now. They're trying to form a wall inside so they'll allow them to get to the basket and get hold.
Dozier is held by Tyler Smith.
Well, you know, Coach Domi on the phone yesterday, he said, I'm going to put him on the foul line. He said, we're going to grab and hold. We're going to put him on the line. They have to prove they can make free throws. They shoot 58% as a team. Not in the bonus yet.
Rose driving on Howell.
Why not post him up, bring him right inside like that. Taking right him one-on-one, bring him to the inside.
Derrick Rose with a game-high 16 points.
And nothing really forced. All good shots. I'm so impressed with Derrick Rose.
Dozier commits a foul away from the ball. Or is it Douglas Roberts? It's Douglas Roberts with a Memphis foul. Tennessee leading by four.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by DirecTV, must-have equipment for any sports fan, and in part by Coca-Cola Zero, real Coke taste, zero calories, enjoy Coke-ness.
I think if you go into that as an opportunity to knock off a team seeking perfection, you have to be intense. We really believed we were going to win in that ball game. And to me, that's the single most important thing.
You don't want that pressure on you. You just can't survive with that pressure. It's a total distraction. Streaks are made to be broken.
Will the Tigers' streaks be broken here tonight? The last undefeated champions in the NFL, of course, it's the Dolphins in 1972, thanks to the Giants beating the Patriots this year. College basketball, as mentioned, Bob Knight's Hoosier team in 1976. UConn on the women's side in 2002, 39-0, led by Diana Taurasi. And then in college football, Texas at 13-0 in 2005. The Memphis Tigers' 26-0 start is on the line here tonight.
Well, they're two guards and 3-for-15 when you look at Lofton and Smith, yet they're still in great shape here.
And again, we harken back to what Bruce Pearl said to Aaron at the end of the first half. They just can't beat us all night long by shooting threes. And again, the Tigers started 7 of 11. They're 1 of 13 from beyond the arc since.
You know, I told you early in the game, Dan, I thought his philosophy was very wise. Even though Memphis was making threes, I mean, I said to you, and I think you looked at me kind of strange. I said, good philosophy, back it up, let him shoot the three. Eventually, reality would set in. Well, they've gone over 21 minutes without making a three now, Memphis. I mean, the last one they made was with 8:51 on the clock in the first half.
I look at you strange for a variety of reasons, by the way. 5-point lead for the Bulls, 7:55 to go. And again, Joey Dorsey has 4 fouls for Memphis. So their best interior defender, shot blocker, rebounder, he's on the bench tallying off right now.
You know, also Anderson had 27 against UAB. In fact, he and Chris Douglas Roberts had 59 of the points that game. He's only got 6 here.
That was their closest call, a 1-point win on the road at UAB a week ago. Rose defended by Ramar Smith, baseline jumper. He has made some tough shots tonight.
I tell you, his stock is going up and up and up in the eyes of a lot of people. It was up there to start the season. He likes the big stage, the big moment. They're not going away. I tell you, the Memphis kids aren't just going to fold over. You don't go 26-0 and just fold over, especially on your own home floor.
Tennessee 24-2. Lofton back in the game. 1-for-7, 3 points.
Right up in his face. They're going to make him try to dribble.
He'll drive and lay it in off the glass.
He did a terrific job taking that to the goal because they were determined that they were going to make him beat him off the bounce.
Derrick Rose picks up the dribble, hands it off to Douglas Roberts. They'll try to penetrate. Anderson with a layup.
And that's what Anderson does. Attacks you off the bounce. We got a good one. Number one against number two. 47 in a row at home. Will it come to an end? Undefeated season. The place now getting excited. Priscilla's in the house. Payton's in the house.
Lofton from the corner. Nice tap. And a blocked shot. Dozier might have gotten it. Here comes Rose. And he turns it over. Got caught in the air.
Yes, sir.
And another bad pass. Sloppy play at both ends. Dozier with a lay-in on the feed from CDR.
That's how you win. Pacella loves it. R.C. Johnson got the best. He's got the best job tonight, D.A.D. He's escorting Priscilla all night long.
Peyton Manning is here. Penny Hardaway is here.
Unselfish play on the other end by Chris Douglas Roberts.
Prince inside. Big he time. Has been enormous here in the second half.
He's been like Candace Parker. I mean, he's been a superstar. She's certainly a brilliant performer down there for Pat Summitt.
What a second half for Prince right here in his hometown of Memphis.
He has been a PT Beer, baby, a primetime performer. He's really performed exceptionally well.
The toughest ticket in town. Good seats going for thousands. Upper deck seats going for hundreds. Everybody's standing, and they're not going to sit down the way Derrick Rose is playing tonight.
He's playing like a genuine All-American, making big plays.
Lamar Smith turns it over.
He's deflected by Rose. He looks a little tired, Rose. He looks really tired. He's winded.
He is.
Oh, is he winded? He's saying, Coach.
Now remember, Memphis only has one timeout, so John Calipari doesn't want to use it just to make a sub.
Rose has got 10 in the second half.
And a push going against the Vols.
You talk about emotion in this place. If you watch these coaches on the sideline, the emotion, the intensity. Look at the emotion here tonight. Does he want it? Does he want it? Look at this guy. Oh, is he emotional?
Remember, the coaches have their own, don't know if you call it a rivalry, but not the closest of friends, recruiting battles, as Rose, now exhausted, does sit down. Allen comes back in. The foul dick on Prince, number 4 on him.
Fortunately for them, they got a bench. They can rotate people. But you don't want to lose a guy like Prince is playing such a magnificent game here.
Prince out right now with 4 fouls.
Hey, buddy, it's living up to its billing. Many times it doesn't. It's going to be a little dramatic. Might look sloppy at times, but there's drama unfolded here.
Dorsey back in for Memphis with 4 fouls. That's him with a loose ball. Anderson, the glue guy on this Memphis team. Kemp for 3. Tennessee ball, 4.5 to go. Good ball hit by Tyler Smith.
Well, shot selection is going to be big here. Free throw shooting is going to be big down the stretch.
Lofton gets a look. Short on the 3. Dorsey the board.
Now you got to really understand what a good shot is. You want the right people to shoot.
Allen leaning into the defender draws the contact.
Well, now you go to the free throw line. 58% as a team. It becomes big. John Calipari said before the game, he told me in the locker room, I'm not concerned. We will make them when the game's on the line. My friend, the game is on the line.
And Allen steps to the line, just 50% on the season. Memphis, one of the worst shooting teams in the country from the line. Rose among those getting set to check back in. A total of 5 players at the scorer's table right now.
Now you're going to bring Prince in. You're going to bring Rose in. You want to make sure your people are right. People are on the floor.
A lot of huffing and puffing there going on right now. This is the first.
I think it's big. I think any time you are not a consistently good free throw shooting team, you add a real dilemma to your club.
What amazes me is I watch you shooting free throws from time to time at the arena just for fun. You go out there, no practice, with your
shoes
your
boots, on,
your nice shoes on. You're about 70%.
Oh, better than that. With one eye, too. I got one eye. I'm 68 years of age.
Another miss.
I mean, there it is. Now, you say it's not really important. There's 2 misses in a 1-point game with 4 minutes on the clock.
Memphis is 7 of 14 from the line tonight. Tennessee is 8 for 14.
Well, that's basically what they shoot for the year. Numbers don't lie, do they?
A clear out for Tyler Smith. And he stepped out of bounds. Derrick Rose will enter the game for the final 3 minutes and 52 seconds of regulation. Number 1 unbeaten Memphis is getting all they can handle from J.P. Prince and the high-flying Vols.
I don't know if we're the best team in the country. I don't know if we are. But I do know we're 40 minutes away from being the number 1 team in the country.
Now, if that doesn't fire up a bunch of young men as they get ready to take the court, I don't know what will. And they've got a 1-point lead, Dick, with 3:52 to go, in spite of a couple of injuries tonight. For the latest, back to Aaron.
Dan, we saw Memphis's Derrick Rose huffing and puffing over here on Tennessee's side. Juwan Smith just limping over to the bench. You can actually see his legs cramping up athletic trainer is trying to work on him, icing him down, actually trying to massage the cramps out. He's in absolute pain. It is physical, and these players are just giving it their all out there. You can see it right now on the sidelines.
You know, Aaron, that's why I love college basketball. The kids play with such passion, such feeling, such spirit. You can feel the electricity.
That has been Derrick Rose's spot here tonight.
He has been absolutely sensational. Getting that medium range shot, not forcing any shots.
First lead since less than 2 minutes into this half, and Rose has a game-high 22.
They were down seven at that timeout by John Calipari. They've been a different basketball team.
Lofton, the floater. Memphis ball.
Crowd starting to get really loud again. Tom O'Connor going to do a great job as the head of the selection committee. Now really going to have to weigh what happens if Tennessee loses here. They got a tough one Tuesday against Vanderbilt.
Memphis has gone nice hold from beyond the arc, but they're getting the ball inside and scoring more.
Foul took place before the attempt. Look at Rose right now. He's going to pull up and shoot that little jump shot. Fading away. Good fadeaway baseline jump shot. You know, I mentioned Tom O'Connor and the job they're going to have to do. I think there are seven legitimate teams going to battle for a number one seed. I mean, don't count out a team like Texas. They got to win over, for example, over Tennessee on a neutral floor.
Beat him by 19. Number one, Memphis. Number two, Tennessee. Derrick Rose misses the front end as foul. The free throw problems continue to plague the Tigers, and John Calipari cannot believe that the Tennessee player, I think it was Chisholm, was not called for a foul on that play. So the Vols get the ball back. Each team is led by as many as seven in a very, very intense physical affair here tonight.
Well, you know, Mr. Perel says, in 40 minutes, are we got a chance to be number one? Well, what about 2:44 on the clock? And you got the basketball down one. You got a chance to be number one.
Timeout taken by Bruce Pearl.
Will they be celebrating in Knoxville, or will they be celebrating on Beale Street?
Number one, Memphis. Number two, Tennessee, from the FedEx Forum here at Memphis. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. The toughest ticket maybe for any college basketball game in the country this season, along with Dick Vitale, Aaron Andrews, and our game day gang. I'm Dan Shulman. Glad you're along with us. Here's what's at stake. Tennessee's never been ranked number one. They win tonight, they will be. Memphis is shooting for an undefeated season. Only once in Tennessee program history have the Vols defeated a number one team, and you've got to go way back to 1969 against South Carolina. Jimmy England leading the way for the Vols with a fallaway jumper. He scored 20 points, and a last second shot would not go for the Gamecocks. Tennessee winning by one.
That's what Frank McGuire had, that Underground Railroad coming out of New York City with all the great New York kids going to South Carolina. I think that program is a sleeping giant. I really do. I think South Carolina's got great fan interest, beautiful facility.
Lofton turns it over. Rose. Douglas Roberts.
That's the guy that want to bring the ball to. He's usually clutch at the end of the game. Hadn't scored. He's limping. He's limping.
Douglas Roberts hobbling back on D.
Well, he's happy with that timeout.
Yes, he
is. Oh, he is limping. He's going down right there to the floor.
Donnell Mack is going to have to replace Chris Douglas Roberts.
You talk about a major loss.
Wow.
I mean, seven down last week with a minute 22, and he wouldn't let them lose. Chris Douglas Roberts. There's Derrick Rose. Talk about making a good decision. He could have went left or right. He said, I'm going right to my All-American buddy because I want an assist.
And he got crashed into by his own teammate, Joey Dorsey, who was looking for the rebound. I don't know if that's what caused it. But Chris Douglas Roberts becomes the latest key player to sustain an injury in this game.
I think a lot of that's the emotion, the intensity. These kids are pouring it out like you can't believe. They're not saving anything. This is for bragging rights. This is to be number one in the nation and to be number one in the state of Tennessee.
It is a 10-2 run for the Tigers to reclaim the lead. 61-58, 2:19 to go. A sellout crowd of better than 18,000 here with the FedEx Forum, standing, chanting, and enjoying every minute of this game.
We'll have another one like this next week.
Kansas and Kansas State. A little revenge game for the Jayhawks.
And then 2 weeks from now, Carolina at Duke.
Oh, wow, that's always special. That's the best rivalry in all of college basketball.
Tyler Smith to the rack. It's a one-point game.
How do they allow him to get to the basket? Nobody rotated over defensively. You got to see ball, you man.
Meanwhile, Jawan Smith, who's been suffering from cramps, has gone to the scorer's table, still trying to walk it off and getting ready to check in.
Now managing the clock, really big. Shot selection, so important.
Rose.
Mack. They've been waiting for him to hit a three.
Yeah.
He has had three open looks.
They haven't hit a three this half.
Exactly. They haven't hit one since the 8-minute mark after the first half.
Started 7 of 11, 1 for 15 since.
Taking some time off the clock.
Douglas Roberts coming back to the scorer's table. You got all the ingredients here tonight, don't you?
The drama. He's the kid I would like to have the ball if I were coaching right here. I want the ball in his hands.
No call. Still alive. Great play by Rose to tap it back.
What a terrific play. You talk about intangibles. What a great basketball IQ to keep that ball alive and give him another possession.
Not a lot of holes in Derrick Rose's game. Memphis with the ball and a one-point lead as we go inside the final minute.
This is a championship heavyweight fight. 12 rounds. I mean, this baby's going right to the last second.
We'll use some clock. It's down to 10.
It's a heavyweight championship. Nice pass, great extra passes. Oh, you got to convert that.
And Dozier and Dorsey, two teammates, battling for the rebound. They turn it over. Tennessee. Oh, what a missed opportunity, Dick, for Memphis.
Well, they had an open layup. They made the extra pass. They executed exceptionally well. They didn't convert. This kid's got great vision, Rose. There's the extra pass right there. You got to convert that. He didn't realize how wide open he was.
Yep. A six-second difference between, maybe seven-second difference between the game clock and the shot clock.
Well, Memphis will get a chance to get the ball back if they were to score.
Smith in good position. Tough D. Tough shot.
Oh, what a tough shot by Tyler Smith. Big-time play to transfer from out of Iowa.
Memphis has one timeout left. Will John Calipari use it?
I would if I were him. I'd call the timeout.
Doesn't look like it.
No, he's going to let him play.
Let him play.
See, if I were in transition, I say yes. But in a half-court situation.
Anderson, no. Rebound, Tennessee, and a foul.
See, I think a timeout right there. You settle them down. You make sure that the right people, in that case, maybe Chris Douglas Robertson in isolation.
This is more personal foul. Take that number 8. And this is Tigers.
Free throw shooting now becomes big. We talked about free throw shooting. What a tough basket right here by Tyler Smith. I mean, you can't fault the defense of Memphis. They were right up in the face. I mean, this is an earned jumper. I mean, he challenged them on that shot. Tony Landis is not a bad guy to take the ball to the basket. Just came up empty.
And a timeout taken, full timeout. Taken by Tennessee. J.P. Prince, who is not a good free throw shooter, but who has been extraordinary here in the second half. A Memphis kid who grew up a Tigers fan will try to knock down a couple of free throws. Number one, number two, you always hope it's going to live up to the hype. And there's been an amazing amount of hype for this game, and this has been fun.
Well, it really has been fun. You know, there's different philosophies in terms of timeouts by coaches at the end of the game. There's no one set way. But I will tell you this. Right now, we talk about free throw shooting. Prince, not a great free throw shooter. So this could be big right here for Memphis.
A guy who's been great in the second half. All kinds of acrobatic layups, and again has come back from so much, the illness that he had, the serious illness, a transfer back from Arizona, and he's been a huge reason why the Vols have the lead right now.
Well, you know, we've been talking all year that this would be the one potential obstacle for Memphis. This was the game that people have been hearing. In fact, Dick Weiss said he put it on his list a long time ago.
A look at Prince in the second half, a block, and then a number of big buckets for the Volunteers.
Why don't we go a little overtime? Why don't we go a little overtime?
Where do we have to go?
We don't have to go anywhere. Nobody wants to leave. Let's play a little overtime. I'll tell you one thing. This will be a classic, no question. The only thing that'll make this look a little bit subpar, if both these clubs can play for the national championship on April 7th in San Antonio.
What a night for basketball fans in the state of Tennessee. Number two trying to beat number one. A one-point lead for the Vols. Prince to the line, a 47% free throw shooter on the season, shooting 1-1. And Joey Dorsey is trying to mess with him. Joey Dorsey went right in Prince's space on the line, and Prince just walked away.
Joey Dorsey should just play basketball.
Yes, he should.
Joey Dorsey should concentrate on being the best player he can be. Remember last year his comments about Odin? He comes up strong. He says, "Get talk to me again."
Prince uses all of the rim, knocks it down. Even if he makes this one, it's still a one-possession game. Memphis has one timeout left.
I think that both these teams can be so proud, their followers, with the effort that both these clubs have given. Look at Priscilla. I mean, is she a little nervous right now?
Two huge free throws.
Wow.
Need a three to tie.
Yeah, you know, don't let him shoot the three. I wouldn't let him shoot the three. When you're down this late on the clock, don't allow him to shoot the three.
They're going to foul Rose and put him on the line. It'll be 1-1 for Rose. That is the ninth team foul committed by Tennessee.
See, I think that's
like
smart
that strategy.
I do. I think a lot of coaches are afraid to do that. I think the three-point shot at the end of the game is too high a percentage shot because the team's focusing so well. And I just think that in this case here, there's too much that has to happen for right now. I mean, people say, well, if he misses the second, they tip it in. But, I mean, you got to block out and get the rebound.
Better put a body on Dorsey.
Yes, sir.
Rose will try to make the first.
Dozier in for a rebound and power. John Calipari's not missing a beat as a coach on that sideline. This kid has been absolutely awesome tonight. I haven't said it all night, but I will say, Mr. Rose has been awesome, baby, with a capital L.
23 points.
And all good shots, all good shots.
The intentional miss, the loose ball rebound to Tennessee.
Not a foul right away. That'll be a nice journey, 380 miles from here back to Knoxville. Well, now if they lose this game, BYU has the longest win streak, 45. Notre Dame, 35. Current home court win streak, 47 for Memphis.
John Calipari uses the timeout, and the worst news for Calipari, Chris Lofton is the guy going to the line. He's an 86% free throw shooter. He can ice it with a couple. Judgment Week presented by Jockey, Monday on ESPN2 at 7 Eastern. Great women's action. Number one UConn against number six LSU. ESPN is your exclusive home for the women's NCAA championship.
I'll tell you one thing, Dan. They're going to be celebrating in the SEC with this potential win because people have been very critical about the fact that the SEC has been really mediocre at best. And here's a big one. Tennessee comes on the road, faces the number one team in the nation, and now looks like they had a great chance to get the W.
They are 3 seconds away, Tennessee, from becoming the number one team in the nation. Here's how some of them feel about it.
That'd be a great accomplishment because, you know, we're really not known for that men's basketball down here. You know, we're known for that Lady Vols of football. And, you know, to be number one in the men's team would be a great accomplishment that, you know, nobody can ever take away from us.
A lot of great players that came through here. And just to be mentioned, one of the best teams to do it, it means a lot to us as a team.
Now the new poll will come out of Monday. If they win, Tennessee will be number one. That won't mean anything when they go into Vanderbilt Tuesday night for a big SEC matchup, 9 Eastern on ESPN. But right now, first things first, their best shooter, Chris Lofton, will go to the line. If he makes two, it's over.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, you want to go to Vanderbilt with a W right now. I can guarantee you that. You know, you talk about the SEC. Vanderbilt's been a very good basketball team. I love your kid Foster. He's outstanding.
This is the guy Bruce Pearl wants on the line, senior and his best shooter.
He's one of the premier free throw shooters in the SEC. And he's not had a good night at all, but he can help his club big time in Iceland right here. How smooth. He made a lot of people realize they made a mistake coming out of high school. Evaluators didn't feel he was the big time prospect. Went to Tennessee and has had one of the greatest careers that anyone can have.
One more level.
It's over, my friends, unless you can figure a way to get a four-point play. Don't want to foul the shooter here.
Tennessee beats number one Memphis.
Offensive rebound and played a big part.
They gutted it out with some injuries. Chris Lofton didn't make a three. They hustled, got the loose balls. And on Monday, the Tennessee Volunteers are going to become the number one team in the nation. And Memphis's dream of a perfect season is no more.
First time in 100 years that the men's team down at Tennessee has been number one in the nation. Never in the history of the program.
A terrific effort by both teams tonight. They played hard. Players were cramping up, exhausted, and right down to the wire it went. As Tennessee wins 66-62, free throws will be one of the stories of this game. Tennessee 12 of 18, not great, but Memphis 8 of 17. That cost them.
Yeah, we talked about that, how I really felt that shooting the free throw certainly could be a difference in this game, and obviously in this game it was, Dan.
Let's go to Aaron with the coach of the team that's on the verge of becoming number one of the nation.
Well, I got to ask you, we heard your pep talk about being 40 minutes away from being the number one team. What's that going to feel like when you drive back to Knoxville tonight?
It's going to feel great, except we're flying back. Even if we're in a bus, we'd be flying. Representing the SEC, you know, really representing the conference. Florida did it with such style in the last couple of years. I think the kids had confidence that they could come in here and win this basketball game.
Coach, what was it like being a part of a game like this tonight on the sidelines?
For a guy like me, it was D2 for 9 years, an assistant coach for Dr. Tom. It was wonderful. We worked hard to get here, but it's about the kids, Aaron. It's about the state of Tennessee. What a celebration of basketball tonight was, and they were not disappointed. I mean, it came down to a last possession game. And Chris Lofton on the line to make two. Was there any doubt that he was going to make them both?
I'm just asking you the questions. I'm not answering for you. Hey, go enjoy this with the team, will ya?
I will, Aaron. Thanks. Great to have you aboard.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Okay,
Dan?
All right, Bruce Pearl warming up to the spotlight, basking in the glow of number one right now. A stunned crowd here in Memphis as Tennessee defeats Memphis 66-62. The Vols are going to be number one of the nation. Next on ESPN at SportsCenter. For more on this game, we'll be over on ESPN News in just a moment to wrap things up. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For Dick Vitale, Aaron Anders, and our entire crew, I'm Dan Shulman saying so long from Memphis. SportsCenter is next.
Robinson with the follow. Wow.
This is SportsCenter.
Number one, Memphis. Normally good. Number two, Tennessee. A thriller. We go right back out to Memphis for the latest. Plenty of other top 10 teams in action. Could UCLA climb out of an 11-point hole and Kansas take into the wire? Kobe's Lakers look for their seventh straight. Plus, can the red-hot Manu Ginobili and the Spurs tie the Hornets for first place? Tiger Woods used an eagle to get by KJ Choi in the morning. Could he defeat the defending champ and advance to the match play final?
You're coaching to win every game, and you're playing to win every game, and you're preparing to win every game. Now, if we lose a game, I'm going to say it's what we needed. We needed to lose a game. But the reality of it is we're trying to win every game. Can we? I doubt it. I doubt it.
Live from Studio F at the worldwide headquarters of ESPN, this is the very latest. SportsCenter, John Butchergoss, Scott Van Pelt, Tiger Woods, and Memphis, both number one, both perfect. So far this season, Memphis has the honors on this SportsCenter.
And their nickname, the Tigers, and they hosted number two Tennessee, the Vols, the most anticipated game of this young season. Coach Pearl had the message for his kids in orange.
Passion, poise, and purpose allow us to win on the road. I don't know if we're the best team in the country. I don't know if we are. But I do know we're 40 minutes away from being the number one team in the country.
Prior to the game, it's not poise. Fellas are hyped. You got to get separated. Let's settle it for 40 minutes. You got Priscilla Presley in the house. You got Peyton Manning representing Rocky Top in the house. First minute of the game, Tennessee's up one. Juwan Smith hits the three. John Calipari says, let's talk. Doesn't like the way things are going. And then the game was paid at the frenetic pace of two teams that are ridiculously deep and athletic. A three from Derrick Rose. Chris Douglas Roberts, a three. Sean Taggart, a three. Chris Douglas Roberts, a three. Memphis up. They're not done. Jeff Robinson, all three of these, and Memphis has got a five-point lead, but Tennessee comes right back. Wayne Chisholm down low. Tennessee was down one at the break. Second half, it was more grinded out, more physical. Maybe the stage got the better of these guys. Oh, maybe they just didn't play as well as you'd like. Wayne Chisholm banks in the three, the big grin on his face. That's priceless. Then Tyler Smith misses. J.P. Prince has got his back with a tip. Tennessee's up four. Then Chris Lofton gets the steal. Great hustle on the floor. Just get it up ahead. Big dunk right there for Prince, and Tennessee's got a six-point lead. Then it's Prince. Oh, sublime with the left. Let's look at this again. Hangs and hits. But here comes Memphis. Derrick Rose, bottoms, three-point game. Then a three-point game still. Again, Rose, the Chicago kid, crossover, silky, same score. Rose, again, to put the home team ahead after the under four timeout, and he's done it. You think that maybe the Tigers are going to win this game, especially after the turnover. Rose looking, finding Chris Douglas. Roberts has got the squad, the Tigers up three, but then, after some great ball movement with Memphis up one, it's Robert Dozier with a miss, and then he gets the rebound with Joey Dorsey, and they travel. Tennessee would respond immediately. It's Tyler Smith, pounded inside. That's a tough shot, and it goes. You want to win a game on the road against number one, you're going to have to make tough shots. Two-point game. The miss from Rose, intentionally, you would think. Lofton grabs the rebound, makes both free throws, which means it's a four-point game. That's two possessions, and it'll take a miracle, and there's no miracles tonight in Memphis. The win goes to Bruce Pearls, Vols from Tennessee. The rarefied air of number one Tennessee basketball, the men, they've never known it. They will. Remarkable stat, 38 times one and two have played. 19 times number one has won, 19 times number two has won. The fellas from game day are there, as always, to lend their perspective on the biggest game of the night. Reese Davis, our do-it-all point guard.
Beale Street has been popping the entire day in anticipation of this game. Tennessee and Memphis, as Scott mentioned, 38 times number one and number two have played, tied at 19 wins apiece, but this the first time since 1991 that the road team won the matchup. UNLV beat Arkansas then. Hubert Digger and Jay are here. Guys, I guess you could talk about this being a battle for the city of Memphis, and the only kid from the city on Tennessee's roster, J.P. Prince, came up huge with 13 second-half points. What was the key in your mind, Jay, with the Volunteers getting this win?
I thought for Tennessee to stick with their game plan. Early in the game, Tennessee was trying to pack things in, make it difficult for Memphis to drive the ball, to get twos, to get to the rim. They took them out of transition, did a great job on the glass, but when Memphis started knocking down threes, Tennessee didn't panic. They didn't start getting extended out on the floor. They stayed packed in, and they made them prove it over the top. Memphis started out 7-for-11, but after that, they only hit one more three the remainder of the game. You got to give Bruce Pearl and his staff and his team credit for sticking with a game plan, and it worked. And they did a great job on the glass, out-rebounding Memphis by 15. That's extraordinary. Yeah.
Two things happen in this game. We said all year, Memphis is going to lose a tough game by missing their free throws. Chris Douglas Roberts missed a key one-on-one at the end of the game. They're actually, at that time, 7-for-15 on the free-throw line because Rose's missed free throw was a negative trying to get the two-point play. But the other strategy, I give Bruce Pearl credit. This game was a chess match. And when he was up three with less 10 seconds ago, they foul Rose. Why? Give him two because you're going to win by one. And that's exactly what happened. Rose made the first. They tried to get the second, didn't go. Chris Lofton, who was 2-for-11 all night in the field, made the two key free throws to make it 66-62. Those two moves, to me, is why Tennessee won.
Yeah, you know, I agree with you, Jay. They played terrific defensively, and they made Memphis shoot from the outside. They had eight in the first half, had zero threes in the second half, but I thought it was the versatility offensively for Tennessee. We mentioned the struggles with Chris Lofton from the field. He did end up with 10 points, but he struggled shooting the basketball. Guys like Jawan Smith, Tyler Smith, Wayne Chisholm, and then J.P. Prince coming from, he's from Memphis, transfer from Arizona, has 13 points in the second half, and they had 19 offensive rebounds. We talked about offensive rebounds for Memphis, not for Tennessee. Dude. Absolutely terrific.
And part of that was because they kept it so packed in. Right. They played man-to-man, but it was essentially a zone because they wouldn't allow themselves to get spread out. That was really a key, and we talked about before this game what the keys were. Keep them off the offensive glass. They did that. Limit turnovers. They did that. And stop penetration. They did that. What a great game plan for Tennessee.
All right, it was a nip-and-tuck game. You picked Tennessee to win it, but let's look at the other side now, Hubert. What do you think this loss means for Memphis?
Well, I mean, I think it's a tough situation. I think at the beginning of the year, or throughout the whole year, we've talked about free throw shooting with Memphis. We talked about three-point shooting with Memphis, and then the game tonight, they couldn't shoot from the outside. Tennessee took that away from them. They weren't able to hit key free throws down low in the stretch, and for a team that is undefeated now and losing this game, being in Conference USA, not having an opportunity to have another big game before the NCAA tournament, it could be tough for them.
They'll bounce back from this, I guarantee you. I like how this Memphis team is. This is a wake-up call. I don't think many teams would go through any season anymore undefeated. Memphis goes down. Tennessee had two losses coming into this game, but they just kept their composure all night. I thought Memphis really panicked twice in this game. Once when they were down and had that lead, got it back, and then at the end when they just didn't get the things done that they needed to do to win the game.
The one positive I would take from this is Memphis didn't play well. They didn't execute their game plan at all. They didn't shoot the ball well. They missed all their free throws. They didn't rebound. They didn't make tough plays.
Right.
It still was a one possession game.
Right.
I mean, you know, that's the positive of it, is if they play up to their potential, they're pretty darn good.
Yes,
not a lot of teams are going to beat them.
Yeah, nope. The great stage here, number one against number two. Perhaps Memphis overwhelmed by it. Second time Calipari has had a 26-0 team lose his 27th game at home. Happened to him at UMass against GW. Bruce Pearl and John Calipari, J.P. Prince, coming home and bringing men to the nation's longest home court winning streak.
Gentlemen, thank you. And with that in mind, what went away for Memphis? Well, it is their first loss of the season. A lot of folks had circled this game, wanted to see what would come of it. Now we've got our answer. It snaps the regular season winning streak at 45 games. And again, as Digger was mentioning, playing in Conference USA, you're not tested in conference season as much as perhaps some other teams. 47 straight home games, that ends as well. Rocky Top. Wasn't home sweet home, but it might as well have been tonight. This is the first time a 1-2 matchup has been played, matching up teams from the state of Tennessee. First win by a road team in a 1-2, as Reese mentioned, as we keep stealing one another's material since 1991. Memphis, the sixth number one team to lose to a number two team in the last seven matchups. And this is what Reese was alluding to. February 1996, John Calipari, 26-0, coaching UMass, gets ejected. First ejection of his career, the Minutemen couldn't rebound. Mike Javis and the Colonials at GW escaped the Mullen Center with a 10-point upset. Now, just some perspective of what was going on then and what happened now. Obviously, he was at UMass. Now he's at Memphis. Both times, and it's so odd, Bucci, how in sports this kind of thing happens. And it mirrors itself more than a decade later. 26-0. Gets to the 27th game, lost at UMass. This time he loses to Tennessee. But the good news is UMass advanced to the Final Four, and you've got to think Memphis has at least expectations of going that far. All right, we go back to Memphis now, and the guys that called the game, Dan Shulman and Dick Vitale.
Well, not quite the celebration on Beale Street here in Memphis that Tiger fans had hoped for, the most heavily anticipated game in years and years here for Memphis basketball fans. But number one loses. Memphis loses for the first time this year. Tennessee beats them right here in Memphis, 66-62.
How did they get it done, and what does it mean for the Volunteers?
Well, you know, I think there were two major factors in this game. Tennessee really dominated the offensive rebounding. That means that Joey Dorsey certainly didn't dominate, and he didn't score at all. He was 0 for 3 as well. I think also another factor, free throw shooting. You could say it doesn't matter, but in the last 6 minutes, Tennessee goes 4 for 5, yeah. And you look at what Memphis went, they went 1 for 6. You're not going to win a one-point game over a team of the caliber of Tennessee going 1 for 6 on a free throw line at the end of the game.
Derrick Rose was great for Memphis tonight.
Fantastic.
Not to take anything away from him, but for Tennessee, J.P. Prince, a Memphis kid, White Station High School right here in Memphis, went to Arizona, transferred back to Tennessee, huge in the second half.
Oh, he was absolutely sensational. He made so many big plays, ended up with 13 points. He was explosive, played with a lot of confidence. And what about the two free throws he made late in the game? And he's not normally a good free throw shooter, but he really was such a factor. Got up in transition, he gave it that explosiveness. I tell you, a big performance, and they're celebrating first time number one in the history of Tennessee.
A team performance as well. Chris Lofton, their sharpshooter, didn't hit a three tonight, went 2 for 11 in the game, yet they still find a way to win. Aaron Andrews with the soon-to-be coach of the number one team in the nation.
Well, I got to ask you, we heard your pep talk about being 40 minutes away from being the number one team. What's that going to feel like when you drive back to Knoxville tonight?
It's going to feel great, except we're flying back. Even if we're on a bus, we'd be flying. Representing the SEC, you know, really representing the conference. Florida did it with such style in the last couple of years. I think the kids had confidence that they could come in here and win this basketball game.
Coach, what was it like being a part of a game like this tonight on the sidelines?
For a guy like me, it was D2 for 9 years and assistant coach for Dr. Tom. It was wonderful. We worked hard to get here, but it's about the kids, Aaron. It's about the state of Tennessee. What a celebration of basketball tonight was, and they were not disappointed. I mean, it came down to a last possession game. And Chris Lofton on the line to make two. Was there any doubt that he was going to make them both?
I'm just asking you the questions. I'm not answering for you. Hey, go enjoy this with the team, will ya?
I will, Aaron. Thanks. Great to have you aboard.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Okay, good to see you.
Dan?
Well, Bruce Pearl is always in a good mood, it seems, and now he's in a really good mood. He's coaching the team that's going to go to number one in the nation on a Monday. Memphis started 7 of 11, but Bruce Pearl told Aaron at halftime, they just can't keep shooting the ball that well, and look at how they finished 1 of 16 the rest of the way. Let's talk about Memphis a little bit. They suffered their first loss. How does this affect them going forward?
Well, you know, I think psychologically, John will do a great job, Calipari, getting him to understand their number one goal is to be a national champ. This game, when you talk about it, a lot at stake in terms of ego and bragging rights, but it's not significant like it will be come March Madness. That's what makes college basketball so unique. I mean, if this was a battle now in football and you could be really eliminated from a national championship right. game, then it becomes a monster. But in college basketball, March Madness, baby, and Memphis will be in the thick of it battling for a national title.
Here tonight, number two beats number one. A battle, an in-state battle between the Volunteers and the Tigers, and the Tennessee Volunteers pull out a win here at Memphis. They'll be number one in the nation next week.
I'm sorry, fellas. I missed the last 30 seconds. I was focused on that swinger in the orange blazer. Did you see me? Yeah, we saw you. Number one versus number two from the same state in AP history. Again, one of those odd statistical occurrences that we see in sports. Number two team has won all five times with Tennessee's victory.